So there's two things that I have done that I put on paper that I consider probably two of the most important things I've ever done. And they're both like diagrams. And then I blew these up in posters. And we have them on our church wall for people to see them. We also have what we believe about divine healing and things like that, that just gives us a clear cut. Now, all of that is in this manual. And so if you have the manual, you can look at it. Now, two things I want to bring up. And then we're going to get into probably into a couple of things. But I believe that these two charts will really help you. He's teasing me. Popping a Coke can back there. So, in the very back, we have questions and answers about healings on page 102. And that is taken off of our website because we have a lot of questions that people ask us. And so, I was trying to get some of them into the manual, not just to help you, but also so you would have kind of a written answer for usually the questions that people will ask you also. So, that's one thing that you can read about. But just before that, on page 100... Now, if you will use this chart, it will help you dramatically. All right? On this chart, you'll notice there are six personages. Okay? God, Jesus, Holy Spirit, Christian, Satan, and man. Now, we have six lines. Then we have six descriptions. Kind of what I call divine job descriptions. So, in the hierarchy of heaven, I wrote these down. Now, this is kind of like one of those things where, okay, you can fill in each one, but you can only use one of these for one of those. In other words, you cannot use this one more than once. And so you have to look down here and find out which of these descriptions best describes God. Then you write it right there. All right? Then you go down to the next one, Jesus, Holy Spirit, and you just mark them out as you write them down so you can't use them twice. And once you get it, now, this is for you in the future. If you ever get to a place where you say, okay, is that God or is it the devil? Well, you just whip this out and you'll find out. Isn't that simple? You just look at, oh, okay, that's the devil. Okay? And the way you know that is that below here are all descriptions. Most of them even use Bible terminology to describe each one of these positions. We have the oppressor, the universal criminal, and renegade enemy. Now, who does that describe? All right, so you just fill that right in there in Satan. Next one is the power executor. Now, who would that be? Holy Spirit. Exactly. Write that in Holy Spirit because he executes the power of God. Now, the next one is the provider of authority. Who gave authority? Jesus. Right? Behold, I have authority, I give you authority. Right? So Jesus, he's the provider of authority. Now, who is the sick or the recoverer? That would be man. Right? Who's the judge, the executor of judgment for all the oppressed? That'd be God. Let me look there. And then finally, the enforcer. Who is the co-laborer with deity? That'd be the Christian, right? So once you get all those lined out, everybody knows their job. The hardest thing is getting everybody to know their job. Once you know your job, you know what you're supposed to do, right? And you also know everybody else's job, so you'll know who's responsible for what. Because it's nothing like working for a company that you don't know who's responsible for what. Amen? So this will help you out. Okay? And you will never question again. Now, next page is this. The divine flow chart. Okay? This is the way it works in heaven. This is the way God set it up. This is the way it is. First off, the original creation. Now, this is the hierarchy of rank structure. Now, I have to admit, one of these, I should have probably changed a little bit the way I wrote it. You'll see why in just a minute. But the original creation, God had it set so that he was in charge. Jesus was with him, right? Holy Spirit, right? They're all in order there. Even though they're all in one, we just put them in this order for better benefit here. Then you have Adam, which was man. Then you have angels, which include Satan, because Satan was an angel, right? So this is the original creation of the earth. This was kind of the hierarchy. Now, this is before Adam was placed on the earth, or actually, this is at the time when Adam was placed on the earth, right? Then, Adam fell. So the ranking structure got changed. Now, it's God, Jesus, Holy Spirit. Then you have Satan and angels, and Adam is below, or man, is below Satan and angels, right? Because Satan became the god of this world. Adam basically turned it over to him. Then, Jesus' mission, right? Which, essentially, was to return us to the original creation. But now that we have an extra little added element here. Because we have not only fallen man, but now we have people that's going to get saved. So now we have two kinds of man. Right? The natural man and the spiritual man. So we're going to have them in two different places. Man is going to be in two places now instead of just one. So here we have God, Holy Spirit. Now notice, when Jesus came down, He put Himself down with man. Isn't that right? Which technically, in the hierarchy, since Satan was the god of this world at this point, it really put Him there also and showed us how to walk in a world where Satan was in command at that point. Right? Now, when He said, "It is finished." Right? He came down, became what we were, so that we could become what He is. Right? And so now it's like this. You've got God, you've got Jesus with redeemed man. And you say, wait a minute, why is redeemed man back up there with Jesus? Because we're seated in heavenly places with Him. Right? Then you've got the Holy Spirit who is at work throughout the earth. Now, that doesn't mean you're above the Holy Spirit. You understand that? It's hard to put them in both in the same place. So, for illustrative purposes, we had to put it like this. Then, under that, you had Satan and angels. And then, under Satan and angels, you have natural or unredeemed man. Right? Because man is still under Satan's domain. Right? So, now, where are you at? You're there with Jesus. Right? Now, the thing to remember about this is, everybody has somebody below them and somebody above them. Now, your position is, if they're above you, you bow your knee. If they're below you, essentially, you put your foot on them. Okay, that's the real general. Now, here's the problem. God told man, have dominion over the earth. Subjugate it, subdue it, right? Have dominion over everything that crawls on the earth. And He named it, you know, and everything that flies in the air and everything that swims and everything that crawls on the earth, right? The only thing God said not to have or never said to have authority over is other men. Right? He never said to have authority over other men. He never said have dominion. Put it that way. He never said have dominion over other men. And yet, throughout natural fallen man's history, what have we been trying to do? Have dominion over men. That's where wars come from. That's where all this stuff comes from. Is men trying to have dominion. Now, Jesus said, it's not going to be among you like it is among the Gentiles where you lord over one another. Right? He said that the way in the kingdom is that you serve one another. So, now here's the thing. God has placed you. We know that we are to be kings. We are made kings and priests under our God. Isn't that right? So we are kings. And we're to reign with Him. Right? That's what the Bible says. Now, our problem is, in times past, we've tried to reign over other men. Rather than recognizing that every benevolent king serves his people. Right? A good king looks out for the best interest of the people he serves. Right? That he is over. Now, he may rule, but he doesn't lord. You know the difference? Right? Ruling and lording, there's a difference, right? He told us to rule, but not to lord. He said, you're not going to lord over one another like the Gentiles do. Now, what Jesus did, He came down, raised us back up above Satan, so that now Satan is under our feet, Romans 16:20, right? That the God of peace shall crush Satan shortly under your feet. Isn't that right? So we're under, why? Because we're in His body, so He is under our feet. So you have things above you. Every being above you, you bow the knee to. Every being below you, generally, as a general rule, you put your foot on. However, natural redeemed man is still under Satan's authority, his dominion, right? Because they're of him. They're his kids. And so, now, we're not going to put our foot on man. We're going to put our foot on Satan. Now, our job is to release man from Satan's bondage, right? So if you look at this hierarchy here, now, people say, but do I have the authority to cast the devil out of somebody that doesn't want, you know, somebody that wants to keep it? Yeah, two reasons. You have authority over demons. They're under you. And you have authority over men. Now, demons you lord over. Men you rule over. You get that? You rule. Now, what that means is, that doesn't mean that you boss them around. It means that you serve. How do you serve mankind? Now, write this down. All right, you may want to write this down. Six words. It'll be a sentence, but there's six main words. You need to get this into you. You need to be able to say it this way. And remember I told you earlier, if you're a female, you're still a son. Right? Because you're in Him. Not looked upon as a female per se, looked upon as a son because you're in the Son. Now, So you say it this way. I am God's son, man's servant, and the devil's master. Right? When you get it, when you get this. Now, actually, another way that you could say it, another order would be this. I am God's son, the devil's master, man's servant. Now, the reason I say that is this. If you are God's son, or let me go from the bottom up. To be man's servant, you must be Satan's master. Because if you're not Satan's master, you can't serve man because you can't get sickness and disease off of him because they're not going to listen to you.
Right?
So to be man's servant, you must be Satan's master. But to be Satan's master, you must be God's son. Isn't that simple? Now, this isn't the weird, we're going to reign and see, back in the 80s, there was this big, I'm a king's kid mentality. And they should have changed it to, I'm a king's brat. Because that was our mentality, right? We're a bunch of spoiled brats. You know, bless God, I deserve to be blessed, and I'm going to be blessed. No, you deserve to be a blessing. That's what you deserve to be. That's what you should be, right? So get the king's brat mentality out, and get, if you want to be a king's, don't even settle for a king's kid. You are kings. We're made kings and priests unto our God, according to Revelation. And so, now, you lord over Satan, you rule over man. How do you rule? By serving him, by setting him free. The way you lord over Satan is by setting man free. While you put your foot on his head, you are taking men out of his grasp. Okay? Your purpose is to set people free. That's it. You understand that? Now, we understand to worship God, love God. That's what God said. They asked him, what's the greatest commandment? What did he say? Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, mind, soul, and strength. And then he added and said, matter of fact, there's a second one that's just as important, like as unto the first. He says, and that's this, thou shalt love your neighbor as yourself. Now, another way of saying that, he said in Matthew 7:12, whatever you would that men should do to you, you do to them. That's how you love your neighbor as yourself. So the essence of this is this. Even Solomon said it. He said, let's hear an end of the matter. Everything is vanity, but let's hear an end of the matter. Love God, keep his commandments. That's it. See, we think there's, there's 10 commandments we've got to follow. No. You keep the 10 when you keep the 2. Okay? If you keep the 2, you can't violate the 10. Technically, I don't know where you get there's 10 commandments because there's 1,050 in the New Testament. All right? But if you do these 2, you'll fulfill them all. See, that's why I want to take it. I want to simplify it for you. That you don't have to know the whole Bible. I'm not saying don't study. I'm not saying don't read. I'm just saying don't think you have to know it all before you can walk in it. Right? That's the growth process. You should be able to know this. Love God. Keep His commandments. Love the Lord thy God with all the heart, mind, soul, and strength. And your neighbor as yourself. How do you love your neighbor as yourself? You do to them what you would have done for you. That wraps it up. If you will live that in every way, you will always be right. Now, I just taught this recently. We don't have it on a CD back there. I taught this at my church, as a matter of fact. And I want to throw this in because it's really kind of... The thing that holds Christians back is you think that there's some reason why God would not want you to set people free. Somehow, sowing and reaping, something in their life, sin in their life, you're not ready. You think there's something that God is there going, nope, not yet. Okay? Now, in Galatians it says, it talks about the fruit of the Spirit, it talks about the works of the flesh. Isn't that right? And it says about the fruit of the Spirit, it's amazing. It goes through all these things. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, meekness, temperance. Isn't that right? All these things. 9 fruit of the Spirit. And at the very end, this is the key. It says, against such there is no law. You know what that means? Let me put it to you in a common vernacular. You can love people. You can have joy. You can have long suffering. All those 9 things. You can do any of those 9 things all you want. There is no law against it. Isn't that simple? Now you think, okay, what do you mean I can love anybody? Okay, now, if you love your neighbor as yourself, that means you can do for them what you would want done for you. If you were sick, you're sitting somewhere in a department store. You're sitting there waiting on somebody else because you're sick. Somebody walks by that claims to be Christian, Spirit-filled, full of the power of God, full of the life of God, full of the Spirit of God. Amen? They walk by in front of you. They have the power of God. Would you want them to come lay hands on you and set you free?
Amen.
Okay, now, in your answer, you have just bound and commissioned yourself into a healing ministry. Because whatever you would that men should do to you, you do unto them. Isn't that simple? Now, that's the essence of it. So if you claim to be born of God, have God's Spirit, Spirit-filled, right? Then you have a responsibility to do to them what you would want done for you. Notice it doesn't say do to them what they want you to do. Thank God it didn't say that. Because if it did, and you walk past somebody on the street corner that's maybe an alcoholic or something, and you'd have to say, excuse me, what do you want me to do for you? And they're going to say, I want you to buy me a fifth of whiskey, right? And we would be bound by Scripture to do it. But it didn't say do what they want you to do. It says do what you would want done for you. So see, that answers the question. Well, what if they want to keep their demon? So, it didn't say ask them what they want and do what they want. It says do what you would want done for you. If you had a devil, would you want it cast out? There you go. Well, yeah, but if they want it, how can I cast it out? Because you have authority over devils. You need to go back to the flow chart. Amen. All right? Everything under that, you got authority over. You can tell them to go. If they want it back, they can get it back. Right? See, I can get you free. I can't keep you free. See, I can get you free because I have authority over all sickness and disease and devils. I can't keep you free because after I'm gone, you can live any way you want. And if you live a life... See, you're going to... Your life will draw like begets like. All right? Deep calleth unto deep. I can go to all these different scriptures. You are going to draw to you people of your level. That's why... Have you ever been around people that claim to be Christian? And they're, man, everything, in church, everything is right. But yet, you look at them, and you're like, man, the words are right. Everything sounds right, but there's something that ain't right. Why? It's because they draw nigh you with their lips, but their heart is far from you. Why? It's because they're in a church mode. They're saying the right thing, you know, even doing the right thing to a degree, but their heart, you know, what are they doing when they go home? What are they doing when they're not around? In other words, are they like chameleon Christians? You know, when they're around Christians, everything's, oh, praise the Lord. But when they're around their drinking buddies, hey, bring me another one. You see what I'm saying? Do you conform to the left? You will conform to the level of the people you hang around with. That's why you will draw that level of people. That's why I told all my kids, don't marry down. Marry up. Find somebody that's stronger spiritually than you are and marry them. Because they will pull you up because you want to go up. And if you don't want to go up, you'll pull them down. That's the way it works. And they said, is that fair to the other people? I'm not concerned about them. I'm giving responsibility for my kids. Okay? And so, but you should always aspire, right? Your friend, I heard somebody say, your friends are like elevators. They'll either take you up or take you down. But they generally don't leave you where they found you. Right? So you need, that's why sharp, you know, iron sharpens iron. Get around people that sharpen you. Don't get around dull people. Or people that dull you, either way. So, but does this help you out some? Did you see that chart, though? I'm telling you, this, for me, I just like things clear and simple. You know, I don't like all the little things you have to try to figure out. Because I just don't see Jesus doing that. Now, the other thing, let's see, where are we at here? Oh, we're doing good time-wise. Yes, we're doing good. Okay. Back to what we're talking about. Now, we have made it all the way to page 5 in the manual. Okay? Now, we've covered a lot of ground, but I want to hit this one point. On page 5, the last paragraph there says, the principle here, remember we were talking earlier about how God spoke it once and the sun comes back around, the earth goes around, all that kind of stuff, is that we have daylight every day and it's all set, right? He didn't have to get up every morning and say, let's do it again. It continues. See, God speaks it and it continues until he says, stop. Right? Isn't that what's going to happen? Then why do you think that whenever he said, go into all the world and preach the gospel, that only lasted for a certain period of time? It didn't, right? You know, it's funny because everybody will admit we have the Great Commission. And if we have the Great Commission, then everything that was with the Great Commission goes with it. Why do you think? Think about this. No army, no general in his right mind would send in a crack trained troop of soldiers. Somebody that goes in and just kicks the heck out of the enemy. I mean, just beats him every time he turns around. And then pulls him out after he just slapped the enemy around. And then sends in the B-stream with no gifts, no weapons, no tools, nothing. And says, all right, now I'm going to leave. Y'all mix it up and, you know, hope you last. No, you're not. That makes no sense. That'd be like me turning my son when he's a little child, going in and picking a fight with somebody big, slapping him around, and then sticking my son in there and going, well, I hope you can handle it. No, all I've done is make him mad. You know, right? Not my son, the other guy. And he's going to tear my son up. So what am I going to do? If I am a responsible father, I'm going to give my son everything he needs to take care of the situation, even if I'm not there to do it. Isn't it right? I'm going to train him, give him the tools, give him the weapons, tell him every secret I know about that enemy to help him win. That's what God has done. He didn't take away, the end of the apostolic age. All the gifts ceased. Have you ever pictured what that had to look like, if that was true? I mean, they say the Apostle John was the last one to die, right? And they tried to boil him in oil and they couldn't, you know the church tradition. And so he was the only one that we know of that died of old age, basically, at an elderly age. Now, think about this. Here's the Apostle John. The power of God, all this stuff. And remember, he was one of the sons of thunder, right? And you look at these people, and you got the Apostle John. Here he is, elderly, dying, on his deathbed, about to die. And they got everybody lined up because he's the last apostle. When he's gone, the apostolic age is over. All healing stop. All miracles stop. Everything. Can you imagine all the sick people? They're going to be lined up at the door. You know, his disciples, John's disciples, are going to be there going, come on, get them through quick. And he's laying there on his bed, dying. And they're taking his hand here. Okay, be healed. Okay, go. Next. Come on, quick. He's going quick. It's all going to end. When it's... Of course, that didn't happen like that. But that's the way it would have to happen if we really believe that everything left. See, we put stock in men. We keep thinking that it's the 12 apostles. No, it's the Spirit of God. It wasn't the acts of the apostles. It was the acts of the Holy Ghost through men of God. See, that's what we keep trying to build up men instead of exalting Jesus. We have a thing on our, actually down our church. It says that we are to exalt God, exhort men, exhaust the devil. That's our job. Okay? Exalt God, exhort men, and exhaust the devil. Unfortunately, usually it's all mixed around. Okay? You can change those words around. That's usually the way it is in the church most of the time. But anyway, God said it once and it happened, right? So the principle here is this, that God only has to say something one time for it to come to pass. And it will continue coming past until he changes it or says it stops. Now, there's not one scripture in the Bible that says healing stop. There's people that tried to make it say that, but there is nothing that even remotely says it. The closest it comes, or I should say the scripture that they try to use, is it says that when the perfect has come, all these things will stop. Okay? Well, the perfect there is a Greek word teleosis, and it means when everything has come to full age and full completion, and we have all matured up, and we don't need those things anymore. Now, to be honest with you, we're going to need healing until there's no sick. All right? So, apparently, whenever we have got to a place where we get all the sick healed, then those things might stop. Okay? And a point where we walk in divine health or whatever. Now, is it going to happen here? Is it not going to happen here? That's for the theologians to fill out. All I know is I'm busy. All right? They can sort all that stuff out. Now, let's look at this. In Isaiah chapter 53, matter of fact, if you have the manual, you can go to chapter 3, and I believe I have the whole Isaiah 53 there for you. I should. Isn't it in there? I think I have it in your manual. No, yeah, there it is. I got it in mine too. Isaiah 53. Now we're going to hit this heavier probably in the next session. But I wanted to just give you this real quick right at first. In Isaiah 53, verse 4, it says, surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. Verse 5. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was put upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Now, the one thing that stands out about that whole verse all the way through is it keeps saying, we and his and our, and he and us. Isn't it right? Over and over again. Do you realize that Jesus didn't do anything for himself? Everything he did, right? He borne our griefs. He and carried our sorrows. We esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He wasn't wounded for his transgressions. Right? So everything he did for us. Now, notice that last part, verse 5. Last part of verse 5. And with his stripes we are healed. Now, if you go over to 1 Peter 2:24, I don't have that one there for you. Actually, it's in there somewhere, but not on that page. It says, by whose stripes ye were healed. Now, there are people that would try to say, well, now that's talking about spiritual healing, getting saved, and not physical healing, because it talks about transgressions and all that stuff before that. So it's talking about spiritual healing and not physical. First off, the word used there for healing or healed in 1 Peter 2:24 in the Greek is a word that was always used for physical healing. It was never once used for spiritual healing or any other type of healing. Matter of fact, to even prove it further, there was one time that the word was used in the Old Testament. Remember, the Old Testament in Hebrew was translated into the Greek, and that's the Bible that Jesus and those guys mainly read out of at that time, was the Greek translation of the Hebrew Scriptures. And the same word is used in 1 Peter 2:24 that was actually used over in Isaiah 53. And it was also used only one time that wasn't referring to an actual physical bodily healing. And even then, it was referred to as the temple altar was healed. Meaning that even when it wasn't referring to a human body, it was referring to the physical restoration of a physical thing. So it never referred to spiritual healing. So for someone to say that this refers to spiritual healing, they do not know their Greek. Now, I'm not a Greek scholar, but I have friends that are. Michael Brown speaks like seven languages. And every time I have a question, I can call him and he'll tell me in the Hebrew or Greek. My wife and I were driving somewhere one time and we were listening to a tape of his and he was reading out of the Scriptures. And she said, that's not King James. What translation is he reading out of? And I said, he's reading out of the original Hebrew, because he reads it. That's his Bible, is the original Hebrew, or the, you know, Hebrew text. And so whenever they say that, they say it was spiritual and not physical. They don't know what they're talking about. How many of you have heard of a book called Bodily Healing and the Atonement? By T.J. McCrossin. Right? Not many. Right? We usually care. I don't think we have any in there. They're getting pretty hard to find. Actually, you can get them. But it is the best book on healing, basically, that there is. It is written by a man named T.J. McCrossin, who was the Greek and Hebrew examiner for the Presbyterian Church for their ordination staff. And he was the professor of Greek and Hebrew at their seminary. This man was the accepted Hebrew and Greek scholar of his day. He lived back in the 30s. He wrote this book. The book went out of use. Eventually, Kenneth Hagin and Roy Hicks put it back into publication. It's an excellent book. It's a small book, but it's not easy to read. You've got to really sit down and go through it. It doesn't have these healing chapters like we would think. It has, you know, point one, principle one, that kind of thing. He said, not me. He said he is an authority, still accepted by pretty much every person as an authority of the Greek and Hebrew. Now, he said this. For any person, scholar, actually the word he used, for any scholar to say that healing is not included in the atonement, that bodily healing is not included in the atonement, proves one of two things. The person is either not a scholar and does not know Greek and Hebrew, or he is a liar. Now, you got to take the pick. Now, that's pretty bold, right? I mean, I say things pretty straight, but I didn't call anybody a liar. Okay, well, I've come pretty close. But anyway, now, that's what he said, because he did this study. It is an excellent book. It's worth getting. You ought to get it. You ought to be in your library. You ought to study it. Okay, Bodily Healing and the Atonement. Now, I was blessed recently when I was in New York. His grandson pastors a church in New York, and I got to meet him and talk with him about his grandfather and the stuff that he knew about him and see some books and see some things that he wrote. Now, it is amazing when you go into this. We're going to talk more about healing in the atonement when we come back, I would assume. But here's the point I want to get to. We just pointed out Isaiah 53, 4 and 5, and also down in verse 11 and 12. We're going to look at that too. It says, by His stripes we were healed. 1 Peter 2:26, actually, in Isaiah it says, by His stripes we are healed. Right? Are, present tense. 1 Peter 2:24, by whose stripes you were healed. Past tense. So something happened between Isaiah 53 and 1 Peter 2:24 for Peter to be able to scripturally and biblically change that scripture from present tense to past tense, which means that there was something done that changed it from we are presently healed to we were healed at a definite period and point in time. Now, the only thing that happened between Isaiah 53 and 1 Peter 2:24 was the crucifixion of Christ. Now, we can narrow it down even more so. Because if you go to Matthew chapter 8, verses 16 and 17, it says, first off, in the evening, they brought to him all that were sick from round about there. And it says, and he healed them all. Now, it talks about him casting out devils, and people were possessed of devils, and him healing the sick, and all this stuff. And it says, and he healed them all, so that it might be fulfilled that which was spoken by the prophet Isaiah, that said, by his stripes, actually it says that he carried our infirmities and bore our weaknesses. Now, at that point, it was still, according to Isaiah, present tense. So up to that point, the thing had not happened that changed it from present tense to past tense. So something happened after that point in time, which the only thing after that, that puts us even closer to the crucifixion of Jesus. So when Jesus was crucified at that point in time, now, trying to hurry here, I got about 7 minutes to get this out. Now, remember I told you earlier you didn't need great faith? How would you like to know you didn't need any faith? Well, wouldn't that be a shock? Isn't it right? You know, you hear all this stuff. Well, Jesus said, when the Son of Man returns, shall he find faith on the earth? I'm not sure. I know he'll find lots of tapes and books on faith, but I'm not sure how much faith he's actually going to find. Because everybody's writing books and tapes on it, right? Well, now think about this. All through the Old Testament, every healing, Isaiah himself said, by his stripes we are healed. Right? Projecting forward to the point whenever Jesus would come and bear on his back the stripes, because it's by his stripes. Okay? Let me throw this in. Parenthetical inside of a parenthetical. Okay? Jesus bore the stripes before he was crucified. Right? They whipped him, took him back to Pilate, wanted to let him go. Pilate wanted to let him go, and finally didn't, and then crucified him. Now think about this. What if, remember the scripture, by his stripes we're healed. What if Pilate had released him? You'd still be healed. Healing would still be available. Would salvation? No. I know it's a theoretical thing, but I'm trying to emphasize the separateness of it. The finality of the stripes, of the healing coming by the stripes. You get that? Because by his stripes we're healed, he bore the stripes. Even if he hadn't been crucified, right? We'd still be healed. Physically. Right? I know you don't like to think of that, but he did die, so it's okay. Right? Now, think about this. We're looking at him. All of the old prophets, do you realize that there was no right for any person to get healed, and every person that was healed, according to Isaiah, was healed by his stripes. Every person that's ever been healed was healed by his stripes. Now, whenever all the Old Testament prophets said that, had he bore the stripes? So technically, it was all by credit. Right? All the healings throughout the Old Testament was all by credit based on what he was going to do. Right? Because it hadn't been done yet. Now, credit is another word for faith. And then we tell people, well, you know, put some money down for good faith, or he said it in good faith, he meant, so I gave him credit for it. And then what it means? When somebody gives you credit, they're basically having faith in you. Right? All Old Testament healings were by credit. They were all by faith. Right? Because why were they by faith or by credit? Because he had not been striped yet. Right? He had not been whipped. It had not been. So it was all looking forward. Now, had he not been whipped, then, well, we could go into a lot of speculation about what would happen. But had he not accomplished that, then all those healings would have been illegal. Right? Because they weren't paid for. You understand what I'm saying? Now, but since he bore the stripes, that means up to that point when he bore the stripes, that means that every healing throughout the Old Testament, every time you read about healing, it was based on him coming and being striped so that we could be healed. So it was all by faith. Now, I'm not asking you for your money, but I just want you to think. How many of you have money in a bank account right now? You don't have to raise your hand, but just you know if you do or not, right? Now, think how much money you have in the bank. Now, could you, without any real problem, and without worrying about the check bouncing, could you write a check for $5? Okay? If you have, what, $10 in the bank, then you could write a check for $5. Right? Would there be any hesitation on your part? to write it? Let's say you had $1,000 in the bank. Would there be any hesitation to write a $5 check? Why? Because you know you got it covered, right? Would it take any faith on your part to write a $5 check on a $1,000 account? Any faith at all? None, right? Why? Because you know it's there. You put the money there. If the bank says, excuse me, you don't have an account here. Okay, are you going to go, oh, I thought I did. Okay, I'm sorry. No, you're not. You're going to be right there in that bank teller's face, or you want to see a manager or say, isn't that right? You're going to say, bless God, here's a receipt. I put it here. Here's a receipt. Well, I'm sorry, sir. That's just income paper. That doesn't mean anything. Well, excuse me, it does too. It means I put money in your bank. That's a receipt, right? That shows that you received it, and that's my proof that I put the money there. That's all I have. I don't have the money. I put the money in. Isn't that right? You get the picture here? Yeah. Jesus died. He bore the stripes. Is that fact or fiction? It's a fact. Now, do you need faith for a fact? You don't need faith for a fact, right? You know your name. It's a fact. You don't need faith to say your name. You have money in the bank. You don't need faith to write a check. Why? Because it's a fact. Right? Jesus bore the stripes. It's a fact. You're healed. It's a fact. Well, I don't feel healed. That doesn't matter. Oh, you don't have an account. You weren't healed. Really? That's funny. I got it right here on a piece of paper written. Black and white, right here, says I am. I got a receipt. Anybody says otherwise, they're liars. Right? Let God be true, but every man a liar. Isn't that what the Bible says? Do you see the correlation? This is a fact. Jesus is bearing our sicknesses, our diseases. It's a fact. Do you need faith for a fact? No. Now, do you need faith to get in Christ? Yeah, you need faith in Him, and you're in Him. Now, in Him is healing. Right? Y'all have Sam's up here, don't you? I thought I saw a Sam's Club, because I've got a Sam's Club card thing. Yeah. When I walk through the door, they don't want to see my bank account. You know what they want to see? My Sam's card. Isn't it right? They don't even care if I have money on me, because they don't know if I'm there to buy or anything else. All they want to see, they don't even ask me, can I see your Sam's membership card? Isn't it right? That's all I need. If I got that card, I can get anything in that store. Isn't it right? Amen. I mean, they don't care what I buy. All they want to know is, am I a member? Hello, that's heaven. Right? Heaven doesn't care what you buy. You want healing? He doesn't care. Yeah, healing, it's yours. It's in here. Come on inside Jesus and get it. Have you got your card? Yes, you betcha. You know how I got his card? I got his name. Amen. I got his name. I got faith. You see? But do I need faith? See, I needed faith to get in him. Do I need faith for anything that's in him? No. Why? Because it came with it. Right? Did you have to have faith that when you bought the car that you were actually going to have a transmission? It came with the car, right? Should have. If you didn't, you can go to a different dealer, right? Okay? It came with it. Do you understand? Healing comes with him. It's yours. It's not a matter of you trying to, I'm in. What makes you any different from somebody out in the world? They need faith if they're going to get it for themselves, because they don't have a right to it. You don't need faith. You got a right to it. He's yours. He says if he gave us Jesus, will He not with Jesus give us everything? Isn't that right? He gave us everything that pertains to life and godliness. Doesn't healing pertain to life? If you're sick, you don't get healing, don't you die? So healing would pertain to life. You got it. You got a receipt right there that says you got it. But now there's the problem is, see, we have a person who died, left us a will, and he's not here in the flesh. And now the problem is, we have a crooked lawyer that keeps telling us that this stuff in his will isn't ours. And we'd rather believe the crooked lawyer than to enforce the will and say, you know what, you're a liar. This is mine. He told right there, that's mine. Do you get it? That's why I'm telling you, you don't need faith for healing. You need faith to get in him. When you get in him, healing is part and parcel. You don't need faith to be a citizen of the United States. Once you become a citizen, everything that's part of being a citizen is yours. Right? But there are times whenever you have to stand up and fight for the things that are yours. Amen? Back in 1863, January 1st, this tall, skinny guy stands up and gives this Emancipation Proclamation in which he says, now get this, because there's been some misconstruing going on there. When he got up, he did not say, I am freeing every slave. What he said was, I am freeing every slave in the belligerent states south of the Mason-Dixon line. That's what he actually did. He didn't free the slaves in the north. If you read it, he didn't do it. Yeah, later on they did. But the moment think about this. He freed slaves. The South at that point was a separate country. England and France recognized the Confederacy as a separate country, right? Then Abraham Lincoln, President of the United States of the North, gets up and says, all the slaves in the South, you're free. And that's kind of like President Bush getting up and saying, everybody in England doesn't have to pay taxes this year. Right? The English people say, yay, and the English Parliament would say, yeah, you try it. And they're right, because they say he doesn't have the authority. But now get this, he set free slaves that didn't belong to him, that he had no authority over. Isn't that right? Technically. Now, at that moment, according to the United States government, slaves were free. Isn't that right? The war lasted another 2 years. But do you realize, that was in 1863, but do you realize that most of the slaves did not realize their freedom for another 100 years? You get that? That's what the Civil Rights Movement was about. Because they, you know why it took 100 years for them to experience the freedom that was produced for them back 100 years before it? Because they put up with it. And finally they said, you know what? We're fed up. We're going to have the same rights as anybody else. We're going to have the same rights that was guaranteed to us. And bless God, we will fight to get those rights. Isn't that right? And they started marching. Martin Luther King Jr. followed the principles of Gandhi to the most part of peaceful resistance, that kind of thing. But you need to realize they had to stand up and say. Now, that's the problem. Jesus bought your healing 2,000 years ago, but as long as you put up with it, you will stay in bondage. But at some point, you have to decide, bless God, this far and no more. It ends here today. I am free. It's mine. The devil's a liar, and he cannot stay in my body anymore. So body, line up with the Word of God and be free. Now, people ask me, how do you get healed and stay healed? This is how. First off, it's by what I believe, and my belief keeps the stuff off of me. Then if there is an attack and something actually starts to get a hold of me, I take a walk. And I'll get out and walk around the block, and usually by the time I get back, it's gone. Very seldom do symptoms stay on me more than about 45 minutes at the most. But the reason is I don't let them get time to get dug in. Right? As soon as I feel weird, I'll take a walk, bless God, no. Mm-mm. And I'll start, bless God, Satan. Especially if he attacks my family or something like that, I'll tell him, for every minute you stay, I'm going to go find 5 people and pray for them. So how many people do you want well? And that's what I tell him. And he's learned. You say, where in the world did you get that? World War II. Whenever the French resistance would kill a Nazi colonel or something like that, for that colonel, the Nazis would gather up maybe 500 peasants, take them out in the woods and shoot them in retaliation. Right? 500 for one colonel. Seemed fair to them. Not fair, but seemed fair. So since Satan came up with that system, I figured out he knew and understood that system. And so I just turned it on him and said, okay, bless God, you hit my kid, guess what? I'll hit 5 of your kids and set them free. How do you like that? And I'll keep doing it until you're gone. And it's amazing. When you start doing that, first you have to prove it to him. But once you prove it, he starts to believe you. See, but you have to have the will to back it up. You see, that's the problem. Most Americans don't have the will to fight. They don't have the will to stand. They lay down and let anything go on and say, well, it must be God's will. No, God's will is right there in that book. God's will is freedom. He is for the oppressed. Amen? All right. Now, here's a question. Actually, yeah. It says, 2 Chronicles 16:12. Asa became diseased in his feet, and his malady was very severe. Yet in his disease, he did not seek the Lord, but the physicians. Please explain. What sounds like it is wrong to turn to physicians. Well, couldn't have said it better myself, but you said it. I think you answered your own question there. So, honestly, let me give you a couple of things real quick on this. Just a little section here. People who have problems, sickness, disease, things going on, we never want to hurt them, right? We don't want to put people down, and we don't want to hurt people, and we never want to make someone seem like they should give up or they're not doing good enough, or, you know what I'm saying? We're to encourage, we're to help, we're to build up. At the same time, we are to preach truth. Now, Dr. Lake, in his day, he was very clear. I mean, there was several times whenever, remember the 1918 influenza epidemic? We've been hearing a lot about it here lately. Well, it ravaged throughout North America and a lot of the rest of the world, killing over, 20 million people. And so, it also hit America. And it hit a lot of people up in the Pacific Northwest, and a lot of them died. Now, Dr. Lake at that time had a church of over 2,500 members, which was the largest church in the area at that point. It was so large that he had to hold services in the Masonic Lodge, right? So much for atmosphere. And so, you know, so, and he went in, and there was times whenever he went in to different people, and they would quarantine them. They had to quarantine the homes because of the flu epidemic. And he would violate the quarantine laws. He'd go right on in their house because they'd call him. He'd go in. And there were times whenever the police, he was arrested a couple of times. Dowie was arrested 100 times in 1 year for practicing medicine without a license. And it got to be so prevalent about Dowie that while he was on the platform, in the middle of his sermon, they would come arrest him on purpose because they hated him because he preached against sin and against greed and corruption in the Chicago government at that time. And they would come in and arrest him. He would go to jail, and it got so prevalent that when they arrested him, everybody would stay put in the congregation. He'd go down, post bond, come back, and finish his sermon. That's what they did, and they just kept on going. Now, and so... And Dowie was another one. Whenever he started Zion, Illinois, he said, no medicine, no doctors. Matter of fact, he went even further and said, no pork. We're not going to have any pork. We're going to obey the dietary laws of the Old Testament. He said, no alcohol. Even to the point where he did not even allow rubbing alcohol or alcohol that they used in lamps at that time. I mean, he was that strict. He was so strict. Now, I believe this is over the top, all right? Because I believe God's heart is to help people and to love and to bind up the wounded and not to create more wounds. But Dowie was so strict that when his daughter violated his rule concerning alcohol for the lamp, that she had it in her room, she was using it in the old-fashioned lamp, she turned and knocked it over. Her hair was very long, and it caught fire. And she was burned over most of her body. And while she was dying, literally, he went in and he told her, I will pray for you. After you repent, after you apologize for violating the rule I had laid down. Right? Now, I understand discipline. But I just don't get that. How somebody can see their child, or anybody for that matter, going through the pain of what goes on with burn victims and still have that kind of, you know, whatever you want to call it. It would be very hard for me to even picture that. But Lake was very clear that he would violate these quarantine laws. And there were times that he would go in the house and the police would be called. Somebody would call and tell him. And they would stand out front and wait for him to come out to arrest him. He would see him and go out the back door and go to the next house. And so there were over and over again that kind of stuff happened. Now, I have a sermon of his. See, I've got a bunch of material that's never even been published. Mainly because I checked with some of the publishers, and every one of them, all the major ones, you know, the ones that, like, I can't name names, but if I did, you'd know them, the big Christian publishers. Almost every one of them want to edit whatever material you give them. All right? They want to read it, and if they agree with it, wonderful, and if they don't, then they want to edit it. That's why I can show you that even the books that are out now about Lake, it says compiled by, but it also usually says edited by. And the reason it's edited is because most people won't publish it the way it was written or spoken in the case of the sermons. Because what was spoken, see, the things that I'm telling you is the stuff that was in the sermons that they took out because it didn't go along with current Christianity and what was being taught. See, that's why, see, people love Wigglesworth. Oh, Wigglesworth, he's awesome. And you hunt down people. I've talked with them. There was a guy here in Minnesota, as a matter of fact, that was Wigglesworth's chauffeur. George Stormont, right? Yeah. And I talked to him, man, over a period of years. Albert Hacking? I think it was Albert Hacking. Albert Hibbert was another one. I chased him down. Interviewed all these. I didn't just chase Lake's people down. I've talked to all of them. If they knew Amy Simple McPherson, I tracked them down. I interviewed them. Jack Coe, A. Allen, you name all of them. Every one of them that I could find that was still alive. Well, all of these people had a lot of similarities in the way they did things, but the one thing that stood out about them is that in the early days, if you went to a doctor, you were in sin. And that's just the way it was in the Pentecostal church. You didn't go to a doctor. Then a little bit later on, they said, well, you can, And if you can, you know, it's okay and that kind of thing. And then eventually it got to the point where doctors became the hand of God. Do you see the trail? Now, and I'm not here to say either. See, people say, well, what should I do? I can't tell you what to do, and it doesn't matter if I did. You're not going to do what I tell you to do. You're going to do what you want to do. Right? And, you know, I could tell you what I would do, but what good is that going to do you? Because, honestly, where people, you know why people die? They try to walk in somebody else's revelation. Right? Now, I was at a church in a cornfield in Illinois. Yeah, I think it was Illinois. Yeah, Indiana. No, Indiana. Of a man who was well known years back. Had some tremendous healing, some amazing teaching on faith. But there was a lot of controversy because there was like people died in his congregation, babies died, children died. All these things were going on. Now, if you want to have faith for you, that's fine. I have no problem with that. I will have faith for me. If I need help, I'll ask you for help, right? But if you have a child that needs help, you pray, you believe God, you do what you need to do. But let me tell you, you can decide when you need help. That child cannot, right? Don't make somebody suffer because of your lack of ability to produce, all right? You pray, if it don't work, get help. Live to fight another day. Amen? Grow in faith. I know this may not sound, you know, the hardline faith like you might expect. But I'm telling you, I don't want to see somebody suffer or hurt or continue to suffer because somebody wants to try to stand strong and prove they got faith. All right? Bend in that sense. Get help, especially when I'm talking about children. Right? Don't make children suffer. And don't put rules on people that you can't live by. All right? Even if you can live by them, don't put rules on them. Right? That's called legalism. Preach the gospel. Let them decide. Let it go between them and God. Amen? Is that simple enough? So, I mean, what Dr. Lake and those guys did, this one sermon, he said, how many in here are pill swallowers? That was the way he addressed it. And he said, yeah, I didn't think so. Nobody would raise their hand because pill swallowers don't like to admit it. That's the way he talked. He said, "Let me." At one time, he put up a poster. I have this poster of him. And it says, inviting all doctors, devils, and demons to come watch or doubters. It said, doctors, devils, and doubters to come watch a divine healing service. Now, think of that. He classified doctors with devils and doubters. All right. Now, I can understand the doubters part. I wouldn't want to go as far as necessarily call them devils just because they're a doctor. Right. We got a doctor in Florida. She was a surgeon. Heart vein surgeon worked on something like that. Something I was trying to remember exactly. After she came through the training for about a year, she came through the training a couple of times, different places. We talked quite a bit. I gave her some, if you want to call it, insights, just to help as much as I could. And she went back, and eventually, after about a year, she shut down her clinic, quit practicing medicine, kept her license, but quit practicing medicine, reopened her clinic as a healing room. Because she was getting greater results praying for people than she was in cutting them up. Amen. You see? Amen. So, I could give you three or four stories like that. But that's what Dr. Lake and those guys, he said, listen, this was his stand. He said, if you've got medicine, here's what you do. You go home, you throw it down the toilet, then you apologize to the toilet. That was his opinion, okay? Now, you know, you have to kind of also balance this with the fact that medicine in those days was pretty barbaric, right? I'll be honest with you, in some cases today, it's just as barbaric. In some cases, radiation, chemotherapy, man, you talk about, yeah, it's cruel. Now, it may be the best that some people have, but come on, it's killing everything else too, right? Now, killing everything else, that's not God's way. It may help you. You may survive. You understand? But don't say it's God's way. Why would God cease using the perfect, like he did with Jesus, to go to another system that isn't perfect? You see? Why would he turn over that system to man that is totally outside of it? Matter of fact, you want to go far enough. Remember, and we'll look at this when we get into healing and the atonement, which will apparently be tomorrow. But if you look at, we know that in healing and the atonement, that we're going to go back to Numbers chapter 21, where it says that Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness because they sinned and the serpents came out and bit them all and they prayed and, you know, they told Moses, go get, you know, get us help. And Moses prayed and God said, here's what you do. You make a serpent, you put it up and tell everybody, every man that looks at it will be healed. And so they came over, and every person that looked at that serpent, that brass serpent on the pole, were healed. Everybody that looked at it was healed. And people say, a lot of people get mad. Why a brass serpent? I don't like that. Because Jesus became sin. The serpent represents sin. Jesus became that so that he took that curse for you. All right? They didn't have a crucifix of a man. They had the serpent up there. Now, the amazing thing is, if you look at that symbol, it looked like a little cross with a serpent on it. Now, the medical profession uses the same symbol, similar. Okay? It is, now, they may tell you it's that. It is not that. It has a different name. Matter of fact, if you look at it, there was only one serpent on the tree that Moses put up, but there's two serpents in the medical profession symbol. Now, the only place you find two serpents in the Bible is Pharaoh's court. Whenever Moses threw down his rod and Pharaoh's magicians threw down their rods. All right? And God's rod swallowed Pharaoh's rods. All right? So if you really want to be scriptural about it, then you got to take it back to where it is. And so that's where it comes from. Matter of fact, if you look at most modern medical science, you can trace it back to the same thing. Now, my wife will tell you real quick, it's almost like being a witch doctor. Witch doctors make potions with powders and mix stuff together, and that's the same thing that takes place today. Right? Now, she doesn't preach, so she can say that at home. Okay? I preach, so I don't say that publicly. Okay? But I'm telling you, about 40% of what we deal with at every healing service is undoing mistakes that doctors did. Now, I'm not saying they did them on purpose, but I'm saying it's mistakes they did. All right? You look at the statistics, and let me tell you, if you're going to go to a doctor, you better have faith. All right? Don't go to a doctor without faith. More people die every year than died in the entire Vietnam War of 12 years. They die every year just from misdiagnosis. All right? You look at the statistics, it is amazing at how bad things can be. And yet you put your life in their hands. And then whenever all that plays out, then when you have no, Dr. Lake's people used to call them last resorters. You know what a last resorter is? When you've done everything you can do through man, and then finally, as a last resort, you come to God to try to get help. Now, thank God I'm not God, because if people did that with me, I'd say, hey, rely on them. If I'm your last resort, forget me. Go back to them. They're your resort. For God's people, God should be our first resort. You want to call him our last resort? He should be our first and last resort. Amen? Now, I'm not saying don't go to doctors. If you need help, get help. Live to fight another day. But while you're going to the doctors, learn faith. Learn healing. Learn what you need. Am I being clear enough there that I'm trying to help you and not box you in and not make you think that you're in deep sin if you go to doctors, but at the same time I want you to grow up because I found out there's something better than doctors. All right? Like I said before, if I needed one, I'd go to one. But I found a better way. It's that simple. So there's ample evidence in the Bible about various things, and there's back in Dr. Lake's day, medical science. See, the reason Dr. Lake was against medicine like he was is because he trained to be a doctor. He went through medical school. And he found out, he said, he even quoted some of the most famous people of his day that were, one was the doctor, the physician for Queen, I guess it was Queen Elizabeth I or something like that back in Lake's day. I can't remember which queen it was. But her personal physician stated and said that all medicine is based upon experimentation and improved upon by murder. And that's what the doctor said, right? Why? Because they experiment, and when somebody dies because of it, then they adjust their experimentation, right? So, and again, if that's the best you got, go for it. Okay, but go in with faith and believe God as much as you can. God can direct their hands. But don't try to say that that is God's way. Okay? Now, I said all this once up in New York, and a lady sitting in the congregation, her husband was a surgeon. And she said, we're Christian. We pray with our patients. And my husband prays with his patients. And prayer. I'm like, good. And I've got people sitting in here that would probably say, I'm a Christian karate instructor. And they pray with their students. When I was teaching martial arts, man, I baptized three of my students. Two of them in a in a lake and one in a swimming pool in a motel because I led them to Christ as a martial art instructor. But was I a Christian? Not by any stretch. I mean, I was doing not even what I knew. But I knew enough that whenever they were needing help and wanting to know, yeah, I shared with them. But come on, my life wasn't consistent. The miracle is they got born again looking at my life. So you can have people that are trying to do good in situations, but now we got it. Well, I'm a Christian bank teller. Well, I'm a Christian car salesman. Well, I'm a Christian. None of those things are Christian. You understand? Businesses are not Christian. People are Christian. And if the business violates Christian principles and you stay in it, you're not Christian. Is that clear? Pretty simple. So there, you know. But if I, you know, come on, if I stand up and I don't go along and don't pad the bill and don't do these things, I'll lose my job. You need to lose it. You need to go somewhere where God can use you in righteousness, and who knows, you may become a missionary or whatever else it is.
Amen.
Well, but I'll lose my high-paying job. Well, maybe you're making too much money.
Amen.
Well, I don't think that's the case. Well, that's because you're getting too lazy and comfortable. You know, sometimes we need to be shaken up a little bit. So we find out what's real, because a lot of this stuff's going to fall apart. When it does, the only thing that's going to be left standing is what God brought together. Amen? So, okay. I'll quit preaching and get back into teaching. So, now, this brings up a good point. I'll read both of them, but I'm going to read this one first. Should you walk on a broken foot and say it's healed? Okay? That's a good question, because it goes into a couple of things. First off, I did. Okay? I've done both ways, and now here's the thing. A lot of people argue with what is called the confession message of confessing something and saying, now, here's the deal. If you don't believe it, you're lying. Okay? If you believe it, you're not lying. Now, you say, but the foot's broken, and you're saying it's healed. Yeah? And you call those things which be not as though they were. Okay, that's a principle. However, that's if you believe it. You're not calling those things which be not as though they were to get to believe it. You believe it. And because you believe it, you speak. All right? So the idea... Now, I'm not saying you don't say things until you believe them. Because if you say things enough, you will believe them. But when you have a broken foot or anything like that, that's not the time to try to say it till you believe it. All right? You should have already developed yourself so that if you say it's healed, it's because you believe that by His stripes I'm healed regardless of what the evidence shows. Now, just let me illustrate this. We have huge machines that weigh more than several cars, sometimes even more than trains, right? And these machines literally fly. They're called airplanes, right? They're heavier than air. They shouldn't fly based on the weight. However, because, now think about this, if I took one of those planes and pushed it off a cliff, what would it do? Probably just right on down, right? May glide a little bit because of wingspan, but it's going to come down, right? What makes it come down?
Gravity.
Law of gravity, right? The law. Now, is gravity a fact?
Yes.
It's a fact, right? It's a law. It's a fact. Now, the Bible talks about things. One of the things it talks about is called the law of faith, right? So faith is a law. Now, faith being a law is something that, if violated, comes with consequences. Right? If it's not a law, it doesn't have consequences. But if it has a law and you violate it, it has consequences. Now, we have the law of gravity. But now, because we have figured some things out, we also have what we call the law of aerodynamics. Or, more specifically, the law of lift. Right? Now, the law of lift... You can have a plane, and a plane will go down the air, you know, the airstrip, and when it goes fast enough and gets enough wind under the wings and actually over, see, it's called the law of lift, not necessarily the law of push, right? And when you get enough vacuum over the top of the wings and enough wind underneath the wings, it literally lifts the plane, right? Now, that's called the law of lift. The law of lift, when you get going fast enough, the law of lift is a fact. Right? The law of gravity is a fact. Whenever a plane is flying, does the law of gravity cease to exist? Still working, right? How does the plane fly? It's superseded by a higher law. Right? Now, so the law, remember, it's a fact. The law of faith, right? This right here, the book, the Bible, supersedes the law of fact. Is the foot broken? It's a fact, right? Now, do you realize that the law of faith to supersede the law of fact, like the law of lift superseding the law of gravity, sometimes takes a bit of a runway, right? But the stronger the engine, technically, the shorter the runway, and especially the wider the wingspan, right? The shorter the runway. Now, you can have the law of lift will supersede the law of gravity, and it takes off. But at any time, if the law of lift, if that plane gets slow enough, all of a sudden the law of gravity, it doesn't kick back in, it was working the whole time. But it supersedes the law of lift, and the plane goes down, right? Now, the law of faith supersedes the law of fact. But even whenever, now sometimes when you start in a certain area, the law of faith takes a while to supersede the law of fact. Right? Now during that time, you're going down the runway. It doesn't mean nothing's happening. Right? You're gaining momentum. And when you get a certain momentum, you have the law of lift. Right? You have the law of faith. It supersedes the law of fact. When that happens, usually the healing takes place. Okay? So, you can be flying along, and yet somebody, if you hang around the wrong people enough, then the law of faith, the law of fact, will take the ascendancy or supersede the law of faith, and you will start coming down until you get back around people that will operate in the law of faith, and they'll get back and you come right back up. And that's called wavering. Okay? That wavering, you ever see oscillation, waves, right? Sound waves? That's wavering. Why? Up and down, back and forth. The up and down, when you're up, what are you doing? You're walking the law of faith. When you're coming down, you're operating more in the law of fact. Usually that happens not because of you, but because of people around you. Right? Because if it's just you, you'd either stay down or stay up. That's why it is important of who you hang around. That's one of the seven things that Dr. Lake said was vital to having spiritual power. He said, fellowship with like-minded Christians. Right? It's better to walk alone than to walk with people that flat out disagree with you. Right? Because you can't walk with them anyway. Because can two walk together if they're not agreed? Amen? So you have to walk with people that agree. Now, that doesn't mean everybody's going to agree exactly 100% all the time in the same way. But you have to learn what's vital and what isn't. Right? Where are you going? Is it vital for you to sustain that and to go with it? Now, I have decided. I am going. I'm going as far. See, we talk about fasting and prayer and those kind of things. Now, I'm not against those. I'm for those. When I first started, though, I had heard those are the cure-all. Right? That's if you do enough fasting, enough prayer, everything works. But I never could find anybody that could tell me how much was enough. Right? You know, is it 1 day, 3 days, 5 days, 40 days? You know, 1 hour, 2 hours, 10 hours. How much is enough? And so, not knowing that, I said, okay, here's what I'm going to do. Now, see, in the martial arts, the particular style I was certified in and taught was a very no nonsense, straightforward street self defense. We didn't wear the fancy outfits. We didn't do all the flying, jump, spinning, back kicks, and all that kind of stuff. Ours was eyes, knees, throat, and groin. Right? Get in, get out, get as much done in the least amount of time so that you have the least amount of damage sustained to you. Right? Do as much damage as you could and get out. But it was all based on not Oriental philosophy, but physiology. How to develop power, how to develop physiological power, how to get more power behind a punch. It was all logic and science. Now, I have, because that's my mental makeup, God has used the same thing to bring out certain principles in healing and in Bible. Now, in understanding this, what I realized is that I had to start stripping away the things that didn't count. Now, this goes along with me walking with certain people, because if I wanted flash, there's a lot of groups I could go with. But I didn't want flash, I wanted truth. I wanted substance. Because flash isn't going to help you when your baby's dying. All right? Then all you're going to be able to do is look sad for people and have everybody tell you how sad they are for you. But substance will come through. And so I had to know how to get results, and that's what we went after. Now, I always told our guys, first off, I was certified to teach particular arts. Part of it was stick and knife fighting. I taught police departments and a lot of self-defense type stuff. But it was all, basically it was called scientific street fighting. That's what it was, essentially. And it was based on Bruce Lee's original art of Jeet Kune Do, which was a straightforward, no flash, not the movie stuff that you saw. Okay. Now, the reason I'm saying that is because of this. It gave me an appreciation, not for what looked good, but for results. It built that into me. And even though I don't believe God wanted me in it, I believe that I took something good out of having been in it. You understand? Turned bad into good. Not saying it was God's will, because he kept telling me for years before that to get out. As a matter of fact, I was driving with my son to open another school. We had schools going. I was driving down East Texas to open up another one. And actually, he was taking a nap at the time, and God spoke to me. And he said, how long are you going to pursue something that has an end when you can pursue me and I have no end? And I woke John up and like, this is what God said. And he, what are we going to do? Like, I don't know, you know. I mean, this was my livelihood. This is what we did. This is what I'd, you know. It'd be like, I told my wife one time, I said, I feel like I've spent my entire life learning, you know, basket weaving. And now it's totally useless because I can't use any of it, you know. And then I drive a little bit further down the road, and God spoke again. And he said this. He said, you're using your hands to teach people to kill. I want to use your hands to teach people to heal. I pulled over, told my son, we can't do this. We turned around, went back, ended up closing down our schools, and began. And at that point, nobody was calling me to preach. Nobody. I had nothing lined up. I shut down everything, walked away from everything, had no income, nothing. And told God, you know, what do you want me to do? And I actually went to work at a fast food place because I had some management experience. And so I like to walk, so I walk back and forth to work every day. One day I'm walking, this ex-student of mine calls me up and says, Curry, I'm fixing to open up a school. It's state-of-the-art. We've got all the equipment and all this stuff, and I want you to teach martial arts. And I'll pay you X amount of dollars. And it was, you know, 5 to 6 figures, literally a year. And he said, plus you can have all the private lessons you want, because at that time I was making between $150 and $250 an hour for private lessons. And he said, you can teach all the private lessons and you keep all the money from that. And I'm like, you know, whenever you're broke, that sounds real good. And I, you know, I'm trying to bargain with God. Come on, God, let me know. I'm not going out and fighting. This is just a skill I have. You know, all the things that you try to rationalize it with. And so I'm walking to work one day and I told God, I said, because this guy wanted a 5-year contract because I'd already quit teaching and he didn't want to open the school and then me bail on him after a month. And so I'm walking to work one day, and I told God, I said, God, I got to know something. You got to tell me right now, what do you want me to do? Because if I sign this contract, I am unavailable to you for 5 years because I can't bail. And if I start getting too close to you, I'll have to go preach, and I'll have to bail on this. And I said, so you tell me what you want me to do. Right then, God spoke probably clearer than I've ever heard him. He said this. He said, it's not what I want you to do. It's what I want you to be. And he said, I want you to be my son, and I want you to be happy. Now, see, for me, hey, I was raised Pentecostal. I didn't think God really cared if I was happy or not, right? Because most people I saw didn't look happy, you know, serving God. So I just thought, and then he asked me, he said, when you're my son, what makes you happy? And I thought, well, that's easy. When I'm your son, man, preaching the gospel, healing the sick, raising dead, casting out devils, man, there's nothing else like it. And he said, now you know what I want you to do. See, he took me full circle. And right then, I went to that business. As a matter of fact, I called my student. And I said, first off, I can't take the job. I'll never take the job. And if you ever call me and offer me something like this again, just remember this. I didn't teach you everything I know, and I will come find you. Simple as that. I want him to know that I didn't want to be tempted. All right? Because it was a strong temptation. And so we... You know, we let go, and then I ended up actually at that point. I went on down to my job, and I told them, I said, this is not what I'm supposed to do. Nothing wrong with what I was doing, but it wasn't what I was supposed to be doing. And so I told them, I said, I got to give my notice, and I'll quit. So I gave my notice and went back home and told my wife, and I said, you know, I'm supposed to be preaching. And yet nobody knew us, nobody knew the call. I wouldn't get any, I had nothing lined up, nothing. And she was actually working a job at that time too. And I told her, I said, I quit my job and I'm just going to get a hold of God and we're going to see what we're supposed to be doing and where. And she told me, she said, well, you quit your job. She said, let me tell you, you're not going to lay around the house. She said, you're going to get a hold of God. When I get up and go to work, you're going to get up and you're going to pray and fast and whatever you got to do. to get it all done. And so I said, okay. So she got up to go to work. I'd get up. I'd put on worship music, and I walked through the house for about 2 or 3 hours at a time, just praying in tongues, worshiping God, and saying, God, what am I supposed to be doing? And then right after that, somebody called us and said, we heard about you, because we were getting success praying for people. But it was all private. I mean, it was in our home. And this person said, we have a son that's paralyzed, and we want to know if we fly you up to Asheville, North Carolina, will you come up here and pray for our son? I said, well, I can pray from here. And they said, yeah, but if we bring you up, will that be okay? I said, yeah, okay. And I said, can I bring my daughter with me? And they said, yeah. So they flew us both up. And for that whole week, we wasn't in a church. We were in a house. And the house was packed out. I prayed for the boy. People heard we were coming. They came from Rick Joyner's group in Morningstar. And different groups came in. They were packed in. I started teaching on healing. We'd preach from like 7 in the morning till noon. Then I would walk down the street, eat a sandwich. When I got to the other house, there were 3 houses on that street. They were packed with another whole group. I'd preach from there from about 1 till about 7 at night. Then we would eat a little small meal on the way to the next house. And from about 7:30 till sometimes, well, usually about midnight or 1, we were preaching and praying for people. Out of that, we prayed for 200 people that week. 40 of them had terminal cancer. At the end of the week, all 40 of the terminal cancer patients were healed and declared clean. Amen. Out of the 200 people we prayed for, I don't know of any but 2. Well, let me put it this way. Everybody we prayed for that we know of was healed. There were 2 we couldn't check out and catch up with. So we kept records of everybody else. There was the reason I'm telling you this is because when I started in the martial arts, I was into, believe it or not, nutrition and fitness. I worked at Bally's. You can't tell of it now because we want to drink and eat, but I could tell people what to eat and how to eat and all this kind of stuff. And I was a floor trainer at Bally's back then as president and first ladies, how to exercise, what exercises to do. So I knew about all the supplements and nutritional supplements, all that stuff. I mean, even in the martial arts, I had to certify. I was also in Wing Chun Kung Fu. And to certify for some of the belt rankings, I had to go through some traditional Chinese medicine and herbalism. And so I could tell you what herbs to take. I mean, I knew all that stuff. But I laid it all down to teach this because this is better, right? It works. It's more sure. So the reason I'm saying this is because you have supplements. If you want to know what a supplement does, you don't add 4 new supplements at the same time, because then whatever takes place, you won't know which supplement did it, right? So you take one supplement, you add it in, and you wait until you see the change. And whatever changes take place, then you can say, okay, this supplement has this effect. And then you add in another one. And when you add in the other one, a lot of times you can even discount the other ones. You know, you can discard one until you find out what each one does individually. And then you know which ones help, which ones don't. And then as you start adding them together, you can see if there's a synergism, if they work together well, or if they interfere with each other. Right? Well, I took that same mentality over into prayer and fasting. And whenever I started saying, okay, what is truth? And I said, okay, if fasting is true, then we ought to fast. If prayer is true, then we ought to pray. If that's where power comes from, you understand? Not if it's good to do, but is that the catalyst for power? Because everybody I knew was praying and fasting and still not seeing any power, and yet claiming that was the answer. And so I decided, before I add in long periods of prayer and long times of fasting, I will see how far faith alone will take me. And so we just started praying for people. I didn't fast. I didn't pray any extended, you know, just normal kind of walk around, you know, nothing extended, no set times, that kind of stuff. And as we started doing that, there was a woman that actually was going to come out to our house. She needed deliverance, serious deliverance. We had known her from years before. And my wife had talked to her and her family and said, man, this woman has devils and it's bad. And, you know, she wants to come out and get prayed for. And I said, okay, tell her, come on. So they had it all set. My wife said, Aren't you going to fast and pray, get ready for this? And I'm like, no, I'm not. And she goes, why not? I said, I'm not going to do it on purpose, because I want to show you that the fasting and prayer is not some type of magic talisman or charm that does it. It is faith in Jesus that does it. Now, fasting and prayer can help you get into shape to hear God and be more available. But it doesn't make you spiritual. It doesn't give you power. Okay? Now, as we started, she came out. We got her free. Proved the case. All right? Now, the fasting and prayer, like I said, it helps you kill the flesh. It helps you die to self. But it is not power in and of itself. And it does not give you power in and of itself. But it does tend to make you more sensitive to the spirit realm. Okay? That's why people, witches pray, witches fast. Right? Now, if you have your Bible, go ahead and go with me real quick. I'm going to have to let you out of here fairly quick. To Acts chapter 3. And I will prove what I'm saying here. Acts chapter 3. While you're getting there, it says, a question. How do you help someone who is tormented but doesn't want you to pray for them? Or pray over them. Walk away, walk around a corner, and pray for them there. You do not have to be present, right? You don't have to do it right then. Because you don't know that's them that doesn't want you to pray for them. Could be a lying devil. Okay? So, walk away if you have to. Many times it is easier to pray for people at a distance. Isn't it right? Just like it's easier to love some people from a distance. Alright? So, it kind of works the same way. Like I said earlier, everybody loves Wigglesworth. Everybody loves Lake. You know why? They're dead. That's why they like him. Whenever Wigglesworth was alive, very few people liked him. He was too mean. You know, and it's funny because when I was around Summerall, there was times people wouldn't like him. He loved people. But there was times that I guarantee I have him on tape where he made people mad, not because of his preaching, which is acceptable, but because he said something to a woman. He told the people, I said, come down and get prayed for. You want to come? Come now. He said, all right, ushers, cut it off. Nobody else comes. And this woman snuck in the line on the other end. After he told everybody to stop, he goes down the line, prays for everybody, gets to her and goes, where'd you come from? And she said, well, I just snuck down here at the end. He goes, I thought I told you to come then or not to come at all. And she said, he kind of laughed like, okay. Yeah. He goes, go sit down, I'll not pray for you. And she looked kind of like, are you joking? And you could sense the room change. All of a sudden, he's not this cute old grandfather type guy. Now he's this mean old man. And everybody's looking at him. He goes, I mean it. Go sit down. And then he turned to the usher and he said, I thought I told you not to let anybody else get in line. Jumped on them. And everybody says, well, that's mean. And he went back over and started preaching. And the guy goes, some of you think I'm mean. But let me tell you, if she wasn't serious enough to come when I gave the offer, she wouldn't keep it. He said, you got to come. Whenever I tell you to come, you come running. That's the way he was. You know, and that's what we need a little more of that. But where did he get that? Wigglesworth. Whenever he went to visit Wigglesworth, nobody was there. You would think, here's this general of God at his home. Everybody knew where he lived. You would think there'd be a line of young men lined out the door waiting to have an interview with this great general of the faith. And Summerall said, every time I went there, nobody was there. I was the only visitor he had for several years. And you think, why? That is crazy. That's because you wouldn't like him. He was mean. When Summerall first went up to him, went to his house, he was, you know, all dapper dressed and had the bowling hat and the umbrella over his arm and had a newspaper under his arm. And Wigglesworth said, you can come in, but leave that trash outside. Mussolini and Hitler will soon be in hell, and I'll have none of that trash into my house. And he had to leave his paper outside. Now, Lake, on the other hand, would get the newspaper delivered to his house. And on Sunday morning before going to church, all his kids would come run and jump in bed and he'd read the comic pages to them. And he knew Will Rogers and all these kind of people. So you can see the difference. So Wigglesworth's idea or his standard. See, now we got people, well, I'm like Wigglesworth. I won't even let a newspaper in my house. No, you ain't like Wigglesworth until you've raised 21 dead people. That's when you're like Wigglesworth. And most people want Wigglesworth's anointing without Wigglesworth's life. So you got to live the life to walk in that kind of power. You got to live the life. That's just simple. I can't get around it. Now, but did God say no newspaper? No, that was a discipline that Wigglesworth set. Because if God had said newspaper, no newspaper, he'd have said the same thing to Lake, and Lake shouldn't have had power if he let a newspaper in his house. You see? So you have to look at it. What you believe is what allows God to work through you or not. Your belief is the breaker that allows the power of God to flow through. And if your breaker isn't big enough, you'll only see headaches and backaches and things like that. But if you can start to get your breaker bigger and realize that it's your believing is what counts, then God can flow through you more. So take all these limits off. Take these things that we try to put on God off of him. God won't. Yeah, I've heard people, God ain't going to baptize you in the Holy Ghost till you get that jewelry off. I've heard it. And then I've seen harlots come in. Mini skirts, low-cut tops, everything that people look at and the women all talk about. And they'll come down there crying, mascara running down their face. And yet they'll get down there and repent, and then somebody will come along and say, receive the Holy Ghost. And bam, they'll take off in tongues. Nobody even told them what to do. And here they are, they still got their jewelry, still got their short dress, still got... But the problem, now I'm not saying they're going to stay that way. But you said it wouldn't happen until they changed. And I'm telling you, it's a gift. Amen. See, it's a gift. That's what you got to get. A gift is given. See, there's only two things you can do to a gift. Receive it, reject it. Isn't that right? You can't do anything to deserve it. Because once you deserve it, it's not a gift. Natural reward. Amen. Isn't that right? But we keep thinking, if I can get spiritual enough, God will give me a gift. No, if you get spiritual enough, you'll have fruit. See, fruit is grown. Gifts are given. Let God use you. And quit putting qualifications on it that God didn't put. Amen? And just start to set people free. See, when I get to heaven, I would much rather have God say, Curry, let me tell you, man. You were way too gung-ho, man. You healed a lot of people. I did not want healed at that time. I wish you'd just slow down. I would rather have him say that than to say, why did you walk past them? Didn't you think I loved them? What were you thinking that you were so busy and so entangled in your mind that you didn't see the people hurting around you? See, I'd much rather be in the first category. See, in the military, we used to have a saying, kill them all, let God sort them out. Isn't that right? Well, in Christianity, it should be, heal them all, let God sort them out. Amen? Just go after it. Amen? But we have the other idea. You know, we have this, you know, only a few are going to be saved. Yeah, and bless God, only a few are going to be healed too if I have my way about it. That's what we think. Because few people deserve it. Nobody deserves it. Amen? Well, if you hadn't found Acts 3 by now, just give it up. You ain't going to find it. I've given you plenty of time, okay? Well, now we got to hurry here. Now, Acts chapter 3. This is after the day of Pentecost. That just happened in the last chapter. Now Peter and John, verse 1. Now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. And a certain man, lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple. Who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked an alms. And Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, look on us. Okay, stop right there. Now, poor Peter. I'll tell you, he just did not have the benefit of our modern seminaries. Because his theology is just totally messed up here. I mean, come on. Is there anybody in this room that doesn't know better than telling somebody to look at us? And they're right. Isn't that what? Oh, don't look at me. Look to Jesus. And then what we say? Peter didn't have that theology. Isn't that right? Peter didn't say that. Why? Because you keep trying to put yourself down. And then you wonder why God doesn't use you, why you have no power. Because you keep saying, oh, I'm nothing. Yeah, we know. And you keep proving it because you don't do anything. Because you are what you do. Essentially, if you lie, you're a liar. Isn't that right? You steal, you're a thief. So you are what you do. He that does righteousness is righteous. You know what the Bible says? Hello? In this scripture? So here, Peter must have had something. Either he was wrong or we're wrong. Right? Now, if I have to choose between his results and your results, let me think. Yep, I'm right. No, I'll choose his. Okay? He had results, right? He says, Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, look on us. And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. Then Peter said, silver and gold have I none. Which proves he was Pentecostal. But such as I have, that's what he said, but such as I have, give I thee. Now, think about this. Notice what he says. Listen, he's telling this guy, listen, I know you're wanting money, I don't have money. Now, he couldn't say this a few days later because they laid gold and silver at his feet. Isn't that right? And then they distributed it among the saints. But notice what he said. He goes, listen, I don't have money, but what I have, I give you. You see, again, Peter's theology is just all messed up. He should have known better than to say this. He should have said, like what we say, let's pray and see what the Lord will do. Isn't that what he should have said? Because that's what he said. No, that's not what he said, is it? He said, what I've got, I give. He didn't even say, let me see if I can give you what I got. He didn't say, well, let me see. Lame from your mother's womb. Sounds like a generational curse. What was your mom? What did she do? What did your dad do? You see, he didn't do any of that. He went straight to the point. Isn't that right? He said, listen, what I got, I'm giving you. End of story. No questions. He didn't even talk. He didn't even take time to pray. I mean, he couldn't have been very spiritual. Isn't that right? I mean, right away, he's saying, what I got, I give you. That's Peter shooting his mouth off again, real quick. He says, but such as I have, I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. Now, let's look at this pattern. What I have, in the name of Jesus, rise and walk. Now, notice what he did. He told him to rise and walk, but then he did something to help him rise and walk. He says, he took him by the right hand. See, I'm scriptural. When I pray for people, I'll take you by the hand, right? He took him by the right hand. You notice he didn't lay hands on his head. He took him by the right hand. When he took that right hand, and notice what he did. Took him by the right hand and lifted him. In other words, you notice he didn't say he helped him up. He said he lifted him up. In other words, he did all the work. The man's legs were still crippled. Right? He lifted him up by his own strength, his arm strength. And now notice what happened. And immediately when? When he lifted him up. What happened first? He lifted him, right? And immediately the ankle bones and his feet received strength. Now, what is this called? Healing? No. This is called the working of miracles. That's what it is, a gift of the Spirit in operation. But it's in operation by faith. Peter started first by saying, what I got, I give you in the name. What did he have? The name. Right? He said, the gift I have, I give you. He didn't say that. He didn't say, I'm going to operate in the gift of working miracles. That's what he did. How do you know? Because he did something to cause it. Whenever you do something to cause it, that's called the working of miracles. That's why, see, it's not the gift of miracles. There's no gift of miracles. There's a gift of the working of miracles. That's why you never see it in church. Nobody wants to take a chance to work it. Everybody wants the gift of faith. Everybody wants the gift of healing. Why? Because God's going to do it. We're going to stand back and watch. See, faith is for protection and provision, not for miracles. The gift of the working of miracles, a human has to do something. Right? They have to do something. And that works it. He grabbed him by the hand. He lifted him up. That worked the miracle. He was acting his faith, and the gift of the Spirit kicked in, and the man was healed. Notice the strength didn't come until Peter did something. If Peter would have just stood there and did nothing, nothing would have happened. Unless he'd have kicked into the gift of faith. Right? But he didn't. He was operating the gift of working the miracles. Now, he goes on. He says, and he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God, and they knew that it was he which sat for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened unto him. And as the lame man which was healed held Peter and John, all the people ran together unto them in the porch, which is called Solomon's, greatly wondering. And when Peter saw it, what did he see? All them running together. Apparently they were getting pretty excited about it. He answered unto the people. Here's what he said. You men of Israel, why marvel ye at this? Or why look you so earnestly on us, as though by our own power or holiness we had made this man to walk? There's a secret. You notice what he says? It wasn't by our power, and it wasn't by our holiness. You know what? We didn't fast enough to get this. We didn't live good enough to get this. We didn't do anything to deserve this. It wasn't by our own power, it's the power of God, but he used it freely, isn't that right? And it wasn't by our holiness. We didn't live right to get this. We didn't fast enough. We didn't pray enough. We didn't do all the things that's required. So how did this happen? He tells them right here. Then he gets to preach, and he starts blaming them. Now, see, Peter, he's a real good one to take advantage of a situation. Because he starts preaching, the God of Abraham and of Isaac and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his son Jesus, whom you delivered up. See, he's pointing a finger. You delivered him up and denied him in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. So, remember all the controversy over the Passion of Christ? Who actually killed him? It was our sins that did it. Isn't that right? First off. But Pilate was ready to let him go. But the Jews here said no. He said, you delivered him up. There's your answer. But you denied the Holy One and the Just and desired a murderer to be granted unto you and killed the Prince of Life, whom God hath raised from the dead, whereof we are witnesses. Now, last sentence. And His name, through faith in His name, hath made this man strong. What did it? Wasn't their own power of holiness, but it was the name of Jesus and faith in that name. Isn't that right? So the faith, the name of Jesus and faith in that name did it. Now let me ask you this. How do you get to be a Christian? Isn't it by having faith in the name of Jesus? Okay, how many of you are Christians? Okay, so you have faith in the name of Jesus, am I right? Now, have you lived good enough to deserve to be used? Have you fasted enough? Have you prayed enough? Is it your power or is it the power of God? Wow, you sound just like Peter. Don't you have everything Peter had? Same spirit, same name. Is the name of Jesus faith in that name? Do you have faith in that name? If you don't, you're not his. Isn't that right? So you have the same thing Peter had to raise that man up. You know the only difference between you and him? Peter was willing to not only pray, he is willing to reach out and grab him and lift him up.
Amen.
That's the difference. That's called the gift of working miracles. I got testimonies on that. You're going to get some probably tomorrow as we start talking about it. And we're going to talk about the anointing and what it is and what it ain't. We're going to talk about all kinds of neat stuff like that. Now, I want to stress this to you. If you could live good enough to be used, then God would be rewarding you. It would be pay for you to live right, for Him to give you power. When you think that you can fast to deserve to be used, when you think you can do anything to deserve to be used, at that moment you have just established and set up your own righteousness rather than relying on the righteousness of Christ. And when you do that, you have just removed yourself from truly being used of God. When in reality, the answer is this. When you realize that it's by grace. You heal the sick by grace. You get healed by grace. It's not by works, lest any man should boast. Right? Boasting is precluded. Why? By the law of faith. We believe in Christ. We don't boast. We do our job. We do what we're supposed to do. Amen? Isn't that simple? Tomorrow I got some scriptures. I'm going to show you that you'll like them after you get over them. Okay? So, do y'all get anything out of this today? You have the name of Jesus, faith in the name of Jesus?
Yes.
The only thing you need is boldness. Isn't that right? And you get that by being sure. Are you sure?
Yes.
It's pretty simple. Right? All right. Well, God bless y'all. We'll see y'all tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock. Today, we covered a lot to cover today. So, first off, if you have your manual, go to chapter 3. Get all this lined up here. Chapter 3, Divine Healing and the Atonement. Now, that would be on page 21. Excuse me. Divine Healing in the Atonement. Really, there's only two things you need to know. Number one, is healing always God's will? Number two, is healing in the Atonement? If you know number two, that healing is in the Atonement, then you also know that healing is always God's will. All right, it's real simple. Because God can't put it in the Atonement if it wasn't for everybody and wasn't always His will. Anything included in the Atonement is always God's will. You don't have to pray about it. You don't have to seek God about it. It's just a matter of finding out what is in the Atonement and then enforcing it. Okay? Now, one of the things Dr. Summerall used to always say, he would tell someone, we need to get this done or you know, I need you to do this. And the person would say, well, let me pray about it. And he said, that's all right, I've already prayed about it. The Lord said, it's okay, go do it. And that's just the way He operated. So that's kind of the way we operate. We decide from Scripture what is the will of God, and then we go after it. Once we decide, we don't back off. There was a story. Remember the story of the woman, the Syrophoenician woman, that had the daughter, that had a devil, and she came to Jesus. And Jesus said, it's not right to give the children's bread to the dogs. All right? Now, Jesus was the express image of God upon the earth. He was the voice of God at that time on the earth. Isn't that right? Whatever He said was the Word of God. So whenever He told that woman, It's not right to give the children's bread to the dogs. He was essentially telling her no. Right? I mean, if you get down to it, that's what he was saying. Now, the reason he was saying what he said was that Abraham and God had made a covenant, and Jesus was fulfilling God's part of the covenant of bringing a sacrifice and of bringing the gospel to the Jew first, then to the Gentile. So he could not go into, and that's why he told his disciples, do not go into the way of the Gentiles, but go first to the house of Israel. And so at that point, that's why he told that woman, basically, no. Now, think about this, though. He was the voice of God. And the voice of God told her no. Now, if she'd have been like most Christians, she would have said, well, God said no. That's the will of God. That's the way it is. And she would have turned around and walked off. But she didn't do that. Instead, she said, that's true, but even the dogs get the crumbs. Now, that's her way of saying, you may say no, but I'm telling you, I'm not leaving without it. Isn't that right? I mean, she basically contradicted him and said, you can say what you want, but my daughter's getting healed. And so, finally, now think about this. She said that to him. She said, I'm not taking your no, the word of God, as a no. I'm not taking that as a no. I'm not taking that as a final answer. And Jesus said, woman, you've got great faith. Now, how come is it she had great faith by saying no, and we think we have great faith by suffering under the weight of a sin, a sickness or a disease, and we think it's just great faith to bear up under that thing because, you know, apparently God said no because I prayed and it didn't happen. Now, first off, it's pretty arrogant to think that just because you prayed and it didn't happen that it ain't God's will. Now, there was another time, remember whenever Jesus' disciples, actually it was a man, brought his son to Jesus' disciples to cast the devil out of him. And they couldn't do it. And then Jesus said, bring the boy to me. And so then they brought the boy to Jesus, right? And Jesus cast the devil out of the boy and the boy was healed. So obviously healing was God's will. But yet Jesus' disciples couldn't get it done. Isn't that right? So just because you can't get it done doesn't mean it's not God's will. You get that? Just because you prayed it didn't happen doesn't mean it's God's will. Sometimes you got to push on through, fight, decide, do whatever it takes. I have a t-shirt back home that on my way back from California, we stopped in it somewhere out in New Mexico, Albuquerque I think it was, and there's a restaurant there called Rudy's Barbecue. And we stopped in there and I saw a t-shirt and I thought, boy, that's my t-shirt. Because I already told you, I've never eaten a vegetable. And so on the back of this t-shirt it says, I didn't claw my way to the top of the food chain to eat vegetables. Well, okay, now you need that kind of attitude that whenever something gets in your way, that you don't take no for an answer. Because see, back whenever Jesus walked on the earth, because of the situation he was in, he could and had to say no. He is no longer in that position. Anything included in the atonement, he cannot say no to. You understand that? If it's in the atonement, he cannot say no. Every promise in him is in him, yea, yes, and in him, amen. So be it. There is no no. There's not even a wait. Only the devil says wait, because the devil knows if you wait, usually you'll give up. So if anything tells you no, it's not God if it is a promise. And what you say, how do you know what the promises are? If it's in the atonement. Now, if it has to do with where you're going to go to get a job or where you're going to live and those kind of things, you may need to find out precisely when and where. Now, I'm not saying you have to. I'm just saying you may desire to know when and where. Now, that's like when people say, well, you know, they'll call me on the phone. Brother Curry, would you pray about coming up so-and-so, going here, going there? And doing a DHT, or would you pray about coming here and speaking for us? Right then I tell them, no, I won't pray about it. I'll come. And people say, well, are you sure you don't want to pray about it? Yeah, I'm sure. I will come. Well, why don't you want to pray about it? Because the Bible says to go into all the world. I haven't been there yet. Where you're at, I hadn't been. So I got to go sooner or later. I might as well go when you invite me. Right? If I go on my own, I got to pay for it. If I go when you invite me, you'll pay for it. Why shouldn't I go when you invite me? Does that make sense? Okay? So, I got a good life. Okay? I get to go all over the world, and usually somebody else pays my way. So, I mean, it's pretty good. So, And I enjoy along the way. We get some good testimonies. I was recently on the way out to California. I was with my wife in the car. We were going down, I think, Highway 70 in Kansas, which if you've ever been down Highway 70 in Kansas, believe me, take a book or something because there is nothing to see. All right? I mean, it's just land out there. I always tell everybody, Kansas, when the Bible says that they cast devils out and they go out to the dry places to wander around, that's Kansas. Okay? So, because there's not much out there. But we were driving through there, and there were several highways that kind of went off, and one highway said, or one exit said, Dodge City, Kansas, exit, 7 miles. We were just driving down the road, and I looked, and I said, you see that? She said, yeah. I said, that road there, that goes to Dodge City. She goes, yep. And I said, you know what happened in Dodge City? And she goes, what? And I said, and I started giving her testimonies. I'll probably tell you the same testimony a little bit later on. But I started talking to her about it, and she said, you know, I know that testimony. I said, that's okay, I'm going to tell it again, because I like it, right? And so I went through this whole thing all over again. And I started talking to her about it. I said, you know, I know most of the highways. I don't need really a map or an atlas or anything because I've been all over the country so many times now. I know most of the highways can get me pretty much anywhere. And almost every highway in every state, I get a testimony. Almost every one of them I drive down, I can think, you know what happened down that road there? You take that exit right there, it'll take you this town, and there's a child there with a club feet. They were healed. You go down this one, there's a person there with cancer. They were healed. You go down, and I could just give testimony. I don't know if there's a state. Well, I know there's not a state. But I don't know if there is a highway in this country that we don't have a testimony about. And see, that's a good life. And so whenever somebody calls and says, would you come? We go. There's things I don't have to pray about. If it's in the scripture to do, I don't pray about it. You know, now I may have to pray about when to get there or you know, scheduling and arranging scheduling. But as far as going, that's not even a question. And so the difference is, though, I don't care where I'm at. It makes me no difference. One state's pretty much the same as another. You know, one motel is the same as another. There's nicer ones. There's not so nice ones. You know, if most people like the hotel we're in now, it's nice. I love old buildings, and it's really nice to be there. And I enjoy that the just old stuff like that. When we're on the road, you know, it's Motel 6, right? When I'm paying, it's Motel 6. So, but it doesn't matter to me. I've slept on pallets on the floor. But it's what we're doing that counts. Yeah. Not where you sleep, not what you eat, not even necessarily who you're around, but what gets done. Amen? So, Divine Healing and Atonement, chapter 3, verse 21. Or, I'm sorry, page 21. Been in church too much. First off, sin and sickness, two fruits from the same tree. One of our problems is we try to separate them. You need to realize that they both have the same life source. Right? It all comes back from death. Death is the source. It goes off into one branch of the tree, it becomes sin. It goes off into another branch of the tree, it becomes disease. Simple as that. It's all the same life source. It's all death. And everything that falls into the category of death falls into the category of Satan. So you kill it. Right? You kill sin. You kill sickness. When I say kill, I mean defeat, destroy, cast out, beat, whatever word you want to use. All right? Now, sin and sickness are always grouped together. In the scriptures, you'll always find them together. In Psalm 103, it says in verse 2, bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies your mouth with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Verse 6. The Lord executes righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. Now, our judicial system, as I said yesterday, is based on the Mosaic Law. It is even based on Scripture. Now, man's gotten involved in it, and so it's messed up a bit from time to time. But overall, the system was based on Mosaic Law. Now, what I want to point out is this. If you read, matter of fact, if you go to court, most court proceedings sound almost like King James in the way that they're carried out. And the main reason you need a lawyer is so that they know when and how to make the right motions and how to do things right. Right? I mean, if you're innocent, you would think, all I got to do is show up and tell the truth, which is not necessarily true. Right? You need a lawyer to tell you when to tell the truth and how to tell the truth. Okay? Now, I want to emphasize this because when you look at it, look at two things. Go back to verse Well, might as well start at verse 2. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Forget not all His benefits. Right? Now, the way we would say this in common English today would be, don't forget any of His benefits. In verse 3, He starts to list the benefits. He says, first off, who forgives all your iniquities. Now, how many of your iniquities did He forgive?
All.
Is there any iniquities He didn't forgive?
No.
Because any He didn't forgive, you're going to have to carry the weight and the punishment for. Isn't that right? But if He bore your iniquities, you do not have to bear the punishment for them. Isn't that right? Isn't that the basis of it? Next, who healeth all thy diseases. How many diseases of yours did He heal?
All.
Now, is there any that He didn't heal?
No.
Because any that He didn't heal, you've got to bear. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
Now, if He did not, if there is one sickness, one illness, one disease that He did not take care of, then that also means that that verse there is not true. Right? And if He didn't heal all your diseases, what makes you think that He forgave all your iniquities? They're in the same verse. So you have to decide. It's either all or nothing. Now, when you start getting into absolutes, you're going to find out that that's the way God thinks. Right? God doesn't think partial. See, one thing you have to understand about God is that He is perfect. And for a being to be perfect, they have to think and operate in absolutes. Because if God... See, that's the amazing thing about how God is working with humans. Because He is a perfect being. And He has to expect perfection. But knowing humans, even though He expects perfection and requires perfection, He has made provision for our imperfection. And that allows Him to continue to work with us. Because in our imperfection, we make a mistake. He makes it so that we can get fixed. And when we get fixed, then at that moment, we are perfect again. And therefore, He can deal with us. Isn't that pretty simple? But now, if He hadn't have made that provision, see, He has to expect perfection. Because if He didn't expect perfection, then that would be a part of His character that was not perfect. You understand that? So, in that perfection, He has to expect perfection. He has to talk perfection. In the Bible, over and over again, people say, you know, He didn't really talk much about people backsliding, per se, in the New Testament. He didn't talk much about people, you know, getting out of salvation and things like that. Well, that's because, first off, He's the ultimate optimist. He thinks anybody gets into this, who would want out?
Yeah.
Right? It's too good a deal to get out. But yet, He has to expect perfection. He has to expect people to want to walk in this, even though He has made provision if you mess up. Isn't that right? That if we sin, we have an advocate with the Father. So we have a way back into perfection so that, and as long as we get back into that, then it's like we never got out of it. Right? So He can continue to treat us as perfect even though we make mistakes along the way. It is the perfect system that allows everything to keep running and for Him to keep helping and blessing people without having to automatically, oh, you messed up there, bam, you're dead. Well, you know, give me time. No, that's it. It's over. He didn't do that. He gives you time. See, now, I do want to say this. Most people look at the idea of grace. We're in grace, which means we can live any way we want, and it doesn't matter as long as we claim to know Jesus. Okay, that's not grace. Grace doesn't mean live any way you want and get by with it. Grace means you have time to get right. All right? Essentially, that's what grace comes down to. In other words, I'm not going to blast you now. I'm going to hold off and give you time to get right. Right? Now, that's the way I say it. I'm not saying those are the words of God. Okay? Now, notice. Go down to verse 6. The Lord executes righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. Now, if we went into a court system, and there's two different types of trial. There's a trial by judge and a trial by jury. And you can forego the trial by jury and just go before a judge, and the judge can hear the case, and then he can decide your fate. Now, in a court case, obviously, you have a defendant and a plaintiff. The defendant is the one that's accused, and the plaintiff is the one that is bringing the accusation. Now, if you look at the Bible, all of the Bible talks in terms of legalities. And it's amazing how judicial it is, because you go in, and let's say you're in a system here on earth. You go into a courtroom, but let's say you're not having a... You have waived your right to a jury trial, and you're going to stand before a judge. The judge hears both sides of the case. The plaintiff will give the accusations against you. And then at some point, your lawyer, your advocate, he's called, will give the reasons why you shouldn't be punished or shouldn't be found guilty. Now, already you should start to see the correlation between these things because it's pretty obvious. At some point, the judge is going to hear all of it and he's going to say, okay, I'll make my ruling. And you know, take that little gavel and wrap it on the desk a couple of times. And it's all right. Now, and the way he even has to say it a certain way. He usually doesn't say I or, you know, his name or that kind of thing. He says, all right, this court. Why? Because he represents the court. The court is his authority. He says, this court finds in favor of the defendant. Right? So if he says that, what does that mean? The defendant is vindicated, freed, right? Now, he could also say it this way. We render, or this court renders judgment in favor of the defendant. So if he renders judgment in favor of the defendant, what does that mean? Defendant wins, right? Now, he doesn't say, we render judgment against the plaintiff. You ever notice that? The judge never says that. I decide against you. He doesn't say that. He says, I decide in your favor. Isn't that right? Whether it's the plaintiff or the defendant, whoever's favor he decides on behalf of, he says, he doesn't say, I'm deciding against them. He says, I'm deciding for you. Right? Now, this is exactly what God does. This is what he did here. Now, remember yesterday we said how Jesus operated? That he operated by the golden rule? He lived by it. He preached it. He lived by it. All right? Now, were there times when the Spirit led him to do certain things? Yes, there were. But if you look at the word led, look it up in a concordance, you're only going to find it, I think, 2-3 times in the New Testament. Well, in the sense of the Spirit leading you. Okay? Meaning, because in Galatians it talks about you being led after false gods and false idols. I'm not talking about that because I know that's not the Spirit of God that led people after false idols. But what it says in Matthew, that Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted. Right? Now, that's a leading that you don't need. You find your own way in the wilderness to be tempted. The Spirit. That's why he said, when you pray, pray this, lead us not into temptation. Isn't that right? Why? So that way, if you pray that, then you know if you get into temptation, he didn't lead you there. Why? Because you prayed and your prayers are answered. Right? Now, that's the way God thinks. He thinks you know that. Now, the other time it says to be led, it talks about in Romans 8:14. It says, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. And so that's the other aspect. But there's not a whole lot about being led, but we know there are times when people are led, right? So we know there were times in Jesus' life whenever the Spirit led him to do certain things, but it wasn't like we generally think it is, where it's every second, do this, do that, do this. Because when you do that, you are taking away all responsibility of the person. There's no virtue, there's no faith, nothing. All right? Now, you should learn to be led by God's nature and His character and not by some arbitrary voice or feeling. You understand that? Because everybody can come up with an arbitrary feeling. Usually it follows their soul. I don't feel like witnessing. God's not leading me to go witness tonight. Or God's leading me to stay home tonight instead of go witness. I'll pray for y'all here. See? And nobody can say anything about that because we have grown to accept this idea of an arbitrary leading as opposed to the leading of the Spirit that is in accordance with the Word of God. Because the Word and the Spirit are one and they agree in one. Right? So you can't say, if the Bible says to do something, you cannot say that the Spirit is leading you not to do it. Because when you say that, you're saying you're being led by another Spirit. Because the Word and the Spirit agree. Is that simple enough? Yeah. So it's real simple. If you have a problem being led or thinking you're being led, just read the Bible and do that. And when you do the Bible, you know that while you're doing the Bible, you are being led. How do you know that? Because you won't do the Bible without the Spirit of God leading you. You understand it? The very fact, I'll give you more scripture. People always have a problem. I'm thinking, like I told you the other day, if somebody says, was that you or is that God? And I say yes, and they get upset about it. And in Philippians 4:13, it says, it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to do of His good pleasure. So whenever you think that you want to do something biblical, you know, I'm talking about laying hands on the sick, killing the deeds of the flesh, you know, all those kind of things. Anything that the Bible says to do, when you desire to do that, that's not even you. That is the Spirit of God in you leading you to want to do that. Do you understand that? That's not you. Now, as you have your mind renewed to the Word of God, your mind will line up with it, and it will become more of you. But it's because when it becomes more of you desiring to do the will of God, it's because there's less of you there to argue with it. You understand that? So the more your mind is brought into alignment with the Word of God, the more your mind is renewed to the Word of God, the less there is of the old you to buck against the system, so to speak. And you start to line up with it, and you become more like Him. And the more you become like Him, the easier it is for His Spirit to actually guide you by doing the Bible. Is that pretty simple? Okay. Now, but remember that verse, that it is God who is at work in you both to will and to do His good pleasure. He gives you the will and the ability to do. He will never give you the will to do something without giving you the ability to do it. You understand it? Because that leads to frustration. You tell a child all their life they can do something, and when they get big enough, you know, when you get this age, you can do it, and then you tell them, no, you can't do it. All you've done is create frustration. God is not like that, right? He tells you, He says, look into this Word, find out who you are, and live that way. And everything in this Word you can do. And we have found that to be true. Now, I know, I can tell you distinct times whenever I know God had led me to do things, but usually it's 20/20 hindsight. Right? You can look back, the proof of it's there, and you go, yeah, that was God. But I do not know of particularly of a time whenever I can say that God... There were small individual things, but nothing of any importance, put it that way. Whenever I went and did something that I said, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt, God is telling me to do this right now, and I know it's Him, and there's no doubt about it. Right? Everything I've done, I have done by studying the Bible, finding out the will of God in His Word, and then going and doing it. And there was always the element of, well, you know what? This could just be me wanting to do it. But I went and did it, and it's worked. Now, we cannot base everything on success. Right? The Bible says that there are going to be cities you're going to go into that you're going to preach the gospel, and they're going to reject you. And they're right, the whole city is going to reject you. Now, according to Common Theology Today, you go into a city and you should have success, and you are to have great crowds and great people and great testimonies and all this neat stuff. But there are cities that reject you. So there are some cities you go into in obedience to the will of God to go into all the world. You go in there, you're doing the will of God, and yet those people there in that city are not doing the will of God. They are rejecting the gospel. And as they reject the gospel, you could come out of there thinking, I have failed. Man, we didn't have, you know, there was nobody showed up at the meetings, no great miracles. I must have failed. No, the people rejected the gospel. Now, even if they reject the gospel, there should still be enough signs that you perform while you're there to be able to prove that the kingdom of God has come nigh unto them, the way the Bible says. Because that's, you realize that all through the Bible, every time Jesus ever talked about a city rejecting the gospel, He said, even if this other city had seen the signs that you saw, they would have repented. Isn't that right? So the people that rejected the gospel rejected it in the face of clear signs from God. Which is why they're going to be held guilty, because it is obvious that God was there, His kingdom was there, His kingdom was demonstrated, and yet they still rejected. Now they have no excuse. But until you fully preach the gospel with signs and wonders, they will always have an excuse of being able to say, well, we wasn't sure that was God, because come on, just last week the Jehovah's Witnesses were knocking on our door and they said they're from God too. And they didn't have signs either. Why should I believe you over them? They probably knew the scriptures better than you do. So you have to have something to prove that God is with you. And every time the Bible talks about somebody being approved of God, it was because of signs and wonders in their life. Right? Now, whether you like it or not, I can't help that. All I got to do is tell you what the Bible says. Amen? Now, back into verse 6. Notice, we're back in the court system. And the court system says this. The judge renders judgment for the defendant. Now, when you render judgment for something, that means whoever you're rendering judgment for wins. Right? They go free. They're set free. Right? And go back to verse 6. The Lord executes righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. What does that mean? Is the scripture true?
Yes.
You believe the Bible?
Yes.
You believe every word of it?
Yes.
What it says is what it means, right? No deep hidden meanings. It's right there, right? It says very clearly, He rendered judgment or executes judgment for all that are oppressed, not some. Is that right? So God in heaven. Now, think about this. Did Jesus know the Scriptures? Probably so. He was the Word made flesh, so I figure he probably knew it pretty well, right? He helped write them, okay? So if he was the Scriptures, he obviously knew the Psalms. He quoted them all the time, right? I guarantee you he knew the Scripture that said, and now notice, by knowing this Scripture, this is how he lived. Remember Acts 10:38? What does it say? How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. Is that right? So who did he heal? All that were what? Oppressed of who? Not of his Father. Right? They weren't oppressed of the Heavenly Father. They were oppressed of the devil. So every person he healed was oppressed of the devil. Right? So the Father's not the oppressor. The devil is the oppressor. The devil is the one that brings sickness and disease, not the Father. Isn't that right? Yeah. And you say, well, but under the Old Testament, it says many times that he brought this, he brings that. Now, if you go into the Hebrew language, you will find out that when he spoke of these things and say, when he said, I will bring these upon you, or I will cause this to come upon you, he was essentially saying this: I have put into play a system of sowing and reaping. Remember what I told you in the early days, or yesterday or the day before, I guess it was. In the Old Testament, God had to treat man like fallen man. Under the New Covenant, he gets to treat man like he wants to. Right? There was a barrier between God and man in the Old Covenant that is not there in the New Covenant. Right? Under the Old Covenant, when people messed up, bam, what happened? Sowing and reaping. You get outside the covenant, bam. Isn't that right? Now, he didn't have to bring it on you. He set the law in motion that would cause it to happen. Isn't that right? Now, that'd be like somebody saying, well, I'll tell you what, that judge put me in prison. No, he didn't. You put yourself in prison whenever you committed the crime that put you there. All the judge did was pass an appropriate sentence for the crime. Now, I know we're dealing with humans, so sometimes it's not appropriate and all that other stuff, all right? But I'm saying, in a perfect world, okay, it would be just, right? Now, God doesn't put anybody in hell, right? People put themselves there by rejecting the gospel, by refusing to repent, by living in sin, okay? By the same token, God does not put sickness and disease on people, but they do that themselves mostly by sowing and reaping, because most diseases are brought upon yourself in some form or another. Sowing and reaping, habits, things that you do, all right? There was a lady that, when I was in Dallas, I was on a television program, and when I got done, I'd never done this before, and apparently nobody else had on that television because it shocked them. But when I got done, they said, would you pray for the people in the audience? And I said, yeah. So I looked at the television camera and I said, hey, wherever you are right now, if you're in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, if you will call into this station right now, give us your name and your address, I will come to your house and pray for you. Right? And you ought to see them. They're kind of, are you sure? And for the next 6 weeks, well, in the next 30 minutes, they had the most calls they'd ever gotten. They had over 1,000 calls. And over the next 6 weeks, I spent those next 6 weeks, at that time I had nobody with me, and I was going around from house to house every day, all day, for 6 weeks, praying for people. And usually I'd get a call from, or the call was there from one person. By the time I got there, they'd have 20 people there to be prayed for, because they knew I was coming, and they would be gathered up. So it was wonderful. Come on, it's good to have house calls. Amen? And so I would go to these people. I went to this one woman's house, and she had a crowd in there. And when I got there, she had emphysema, and she smoked, and had developed emphysema. Now, I'll tell you, I have no fear of emphysema. I will never catch it. You know why? I don't do what it takes to get it. Simple as that. Now, there are some diseases that are flat-out attacks, right? You didn't necessarily do anything, or maybe by accident of somehow something got a hold of you. There are those cases, okay? But most diseases are self-inflicted, okay? When I say most. Now, some of them come by excessive worry, right? Stress-induced sicknesses. You are under stress long enough, you'll wear down your physical immune system, and you will get sick. Now, worry is a sin. You understand that? It's a sin. You cast your cares upon Jesus, and you don't worry, right? What is there to worry about? You ever see that thing, why worry? You either live or you die. You know, if you die, what's to worry about? If you live, then you know there's only two things to concern yourself with. You ever seen that little chart? You ever see it's a pretty cute little thing, but it's really simple and it's really true. I mean, because I have learned, I have lost everything I've had about three different times in my life. I mean, everything. One time, everything was in a van. Everything I owned was in a VW van. Right? Shows you how much I owned, but it was still everything I owned, right? And I lost it all. The van was, well, basically it was towed off or something. It was a long story, but anyway, everything I owned was in a van. And when I got back, the van was gone. And I was in Pensacola, Florida, with T-shirt, pair of workout pants, and no shoes, right? I don't even know if I had my billfold with me. I don't think I did at that time. Everything was gone, right? I've had that happen about three different times in my life. And you know what? One thing I've learned is that I lived through all three times. Amen. And I can live anywhere, anytime. I will always survive. And no matter what you try to do to me, I will win. Amen. Simple as that. Why? Because I won't give up. And sooner or later, you'll quit. Right, so I will win. So once you get that attitude, and it comes from God, it's a matter of knowing that God is with me, because you can put me anywhere in the world, I will thrive. I may have to learn to eat different things, but I will still thrive. Amen? Because God is with me. And that's all that counts. If you know God is with you and you have faith in God, nobody can stop you. You hear that? No devil, no sickness, no poverty, no pay rate or anything else. I do not live according to a pay rate. Right, I live according to what I need, and sometimes I get a few creature comforts to go along with it. Amen. So usually that's when I'm on trips like this, and you put me in a nice hotel. Okay. So the idea though is that I have the mindset that I'm going on no matter what, so you can't beat me. Right now, see, because once you got to get a hold of that that it's not just an attitude. Cause a lot of people can have the attitude, but it has. See, faith is not a build. It's not a working up. Most people think you have faith, you got to get worked up. Faith is not a working up. It's a settling down. When you settle down in God and you say, you know what? No matter what happens, every storm, every wind, every flood, whatever, fire, wind, it doesn't matter, all that stuff, when it stops, and it will, I will still be standing on this rock. That's it. And so whatever comes, that's what Paul was talking about. When he said be content with whatever circumstance you're in, he wasn't saying, look, if you're sick, keep your sickness. Be happy in your sickness. He wasn't saying that. He said, man, I've been rich, I've been poor, I've been abased, I've been abounding, I've had good things happen, I've had bad things happen, and one thing I've learned is that God was with me through them all. So I will come out the other end no matter what. Once you get that, and you realize that God will always be there with you, then there's nothing that can stop you. And once you get that, it's great. It doesn't matter. Live or die, who cares? The Apostle Paul had that same attitude. I mean, can you imagine? He wrote to the church and told them, he said, listen, I'm trying to decide. I'd really like to go on to be with the Lord, but I think you need me here, so I guess I'll stay. And he said that while he was chained to a Roman guard. And, you know, he's ready to be beheaded, basically. I mean, they're talking about executing him, and he's sitting there going, let me think, do I need to go? No, y'all probably need me more than I want to go, so I'll stay. And that guard's probably thinking, this guy's crazy. He thinks he's actually in charge here. And they didn't realize he was. And when he got done, when he was done, now tradition says that he was beheaded. There's nothing that proves that, but tradition says it. And come on, if you're going to go, that's a good way to go. Right? It's quick, fast. You know, a whole lot of other people went a lot worse ways. Right? Long, tortured type things. Of course, whenever you realize, even in the book of Hebrews, it talks about the heroes of faith. Even all the people, it tells how they got somewhere sawn asunder and all these different, you know, ways that they died. But it even says at one time, it says that they forsook their deliverance. You know what that means? That means deliverance was available. And they decided not to take the way out. Why? The word tells you. So that they could obtain a greater resurrection. Now think about that. Think of the mentality that those people had. To the point where they decided, you know, if I call on God, He'll deliver me. But come on, if I die this way, it's going to be a greater glory. So, okay, go ahead, do your best. Or your worst, as the case may be. And that's the way they lived. See, that's what the church is missing today. That's why I like to read all these old guys. You know, guys, a lot of the theologians today, They lack substance. The old guys, those are the ones when you read it, something grabs a hold of you. Dr. Lake's material, you read it, there's something different. There's a certain truth there that you only get by living it. See, that's the difference. Anybody can preach. Most preaching is repeating what somebody else has already said. That's why most time you turn on television or, you know, this is a great new revelation, everybody's getting it. No, it's one person heard it from another person. You know, one week they preach it, next week everybody else is preaching it. They don't have a revelation of it. They don't understand it. They just heard it and go, wow, that'll bring you an offering. So then they all preach it. And they don't have the substance to it. And whenever truth has a ring to it, and whenever you live something, the way you preach it has a ring to it that just says this is real, this is true, even if it goes against everything that you've been taught before. That's why the last 3 days, almost those of you that haven't heard the teaching before, and this is something brand new to you, that's why you've been listening to it. And the whole time you've been listening, your head's been saying, well, that's not what I was taught. Well, I've never heard that before. And that goes exactly against what I was taught. And your head's going, wait a minute, I don't know. But in here, your spirit's going, yeah, that's right, that's Scripture. And Scripture start going off. That means this. And yeah, that lines up with this. And because I haven't violated any Scriptures. And you start to realize that these other doctrines violate many Scriptures. But it's because your spirit was right. It was put into you at your new birth. And that's why your head has to start to line up with that. That's what you've been. That's what's been going on the last few days, is we've been trying to line your head up with your heart. So, judgment for all that are oppressed. Remember Acts 10:38, what I just quoted a few minutes ago? Hey, what about doing good and healing all that were oppressed? How could he heal all that were oppressed? You know what that means? That means that everybody he came into contact with, he healed. If they were sick, he healed them, right? Because he healed all. Many times it says great multitudes came to him and he healed them all. He didn't heal some of them. He didn't pick and choose because he can't. Why? Because he told his disciples, freely you've received, freely give. What does that mean? In common English, it means don't pick and choose. Give it to anybody. Isn't it right? That wasn't talking about offering like we said before. That's talking, he said, heal the sick, raise the dead, cast out devils. Freely you've received, freely give. He was talking about freely giving, healing to the sick, casting out the devils, freely raising the dead, all that stuff. It should be free. That was one of the things when I first started praying for people. Man, I was struggling. Straining is a better way. I mean, when I'd pray for somebody, boy, I'd lay hands on them. And I mean, I would strain, you know, because you're trying to force it. And blood vessels would start popping out, you know, and start turning red. And it's work, you know. You start sweating and turn red. And when you get done, you're like, you're just exhausted because you're trying to force it into them, take it. You know, and you're all tensed up because you want it for them so bad. And you think somehow you got to get it that way. And then I watched this guy on video one time. And this guy was amazing. He looked like a basketball player. You know, he was fairly tall, fairly thin, and he'd call people down and go, watch this, just come on down. And he'd call somebody, you come on down, and they'd come running down, and they'd get near him, and he'd go, just hug me. They'd hug him, and when they hugged him, bam, they'd fall down. And he'd take the microphone and say, how's that feel? I'm healed. And they'd run toward him, he goes, and they would come running down the deal, and he'd go to the side. And they would run and go, wham, and fall from the side. Bam. I mean, And people would get from him and say, look at me. Look at my eyes. You see my eyes? This isn't the... He goes, I'm not wondering. I'm not wondering what if. He says, this is the you can't help but take it anointing. He says, so just take it. And bam. He'd look at him and say, he'd just take him by the hand. And he'd walk with him. And as he walked back and forth, he'd walk a couple of steps. And then he'd turn around. He'd take him by the hand and walk the other way. And he'd come back around. And finally he'd go, all right, you feel that? And they're like, no. He goes, that's good because I don't either. He goes, but it ain't got about, it's not about feeling. And he just go back and forth and switch hands. And finally he get a third point and he go, ha! And they're all of a sudden like, bam, fall down, get up healed. Every time, why? Because you release it. And I'm watching this guy, I thought, man, that's easy. I mean, he's like, you ever see a basketball player? They got that, you know, they're in the guard position. They're out there and they're kind of back and forth and just guarding the person. That's the way he was. It was just easy. And when he got done, man, he was refreshed and ready to go. And I thought, that's the way it should be. And I watched him and I said, I want that. I want to minister like that. And so the next time I got a chance to minister, guess what I did? I acted just like him. And you know what? It worked. I was acting. I got a hold of some videotapes with David Hogan. Started watching his videotapes. Man, got pumped. Sat there in my chair for 2 weeks. Cried the whole time. My wife said, what is wrong with you? Sitting here crying, can't get you to move. You're watching these things over. I mean, I wore these things out. She goes, what is wrong with you? And I'm like, he is living the life I've been preaching. I want to live it. I don't want to keep preaching about it. I want to live it. And so I watched him for about a full 2 weeks, watched all his videos, and what I kept saying, I want that. I want that grit. I want that tenacity. I want that, just that ability to stick. And so, and as a matter of fact, I'll probably tell you about this more a little bit later on today because I bring it in at a certain time because it kind of ties everything together. But I'll just tell you just like I did this other guy. It came to a point where I had an opportunity. Nobody knew how I preached. I didn't have tapes out or CDs or anything else. Nobody knew anything about me. And I was going out there and I thought, you know what? These people don't know me. I can go out there and act like anybody I want to and they wouldn't know I was acting. I can preach any way I want to and they wouldn't know. They had never heard me preach. So I just went out there and acted like him, talked like him, preached like him. And you know what? It worked. Now, the first time I did it, I was acting. But after that night, I never had to act again because now it was real. And it was mine. And I'd done it, and then I could be that way. And I realized that the stronger, the bolder I get, the more forceful I get, the better it works. And so I just haven't found the end yet. Right? So we're just still pushing. So, here. Judgment for all that are oppressed. All that are oppressed. God. Now, do you realize when God spoke this by His Spirit to David, Jesus had not yet come. Isn't that right? He had not yet been there. He had not yet come to the earth. But God decreed judgment for, which means victory for, freedom for all that are oppressed. Isn't that right? Right then when he said that, he said he executes righteousness and judgment for all that are oppressed. When Jesus, I hate to say when he read that, but he did in his earthly life, obviously he did read this. And when he read that, he said right there, my Father has decreed judgment for the oppressed. So oppressed, you're free. Now my job is to go about setting them free. Isn't that simple? His word is forever settled in heaven. Didn't we read that yesterday? So if his word is settled, that word is settled. So God has executed judgment for the oppressed, which means God has decreed all oppressed people free. How did He do that? He sent Jesus. Jesus died, first He was whipped, and then He died on the cross. Isn't that right? And that paid for that judgment, that paid for the oppressed to go free. And now Jesus was going along and setting the oppressed free because He knew He was going to accomplish His goal, which was to die for everybody. Even when Jesus was operating, He was operating by faith. Because He had not yet died. Like I said yesterday, all that stuff, all that before the cross could have been by faith, or was by faith, and could have been wrong if He had not went through with it. But He did go through with it. And therefore, He bought freedom for the oppressed. It's a fact. It is an established fact. It's not a faith thing. It's a fact thing. The fact that Jesus was crucified is in historical record on the earth, not just the Bible. So it is a fact. He died and was resurrected, right? And when He was resurrected, that ended it all. At that point on, we now see, we're not trying to get the victory. We are fighting from a position of victory. The enemy is trying to take our victory from us. That's what we need to realize. In military terms, we have the high ground. We're on top of the mountain. And the beauty of it is, basically Jesus took us in a helicopter and put us on top of the mountain. And now we're fighting from that high ground position, and all we got to do is keep the enemy off the mountain. And it's pretty easy when you have the high ground. Amen? Now, when it says that he had judgment for all the oppressed, that means that Jesus, when He showed up, He said, you're oppressed, so you can be free. Why? Because my Father has executed judgment for all the oppressed. He has set a decree that all oppressed are to go free. You say, I don't think God ever did that. Oh, yeah. Even under the old covenant, they did. It's called the year of Jubilee. Isn't that right? Even under the year... See, what was that? That was a foreshadow of what was going to come. Under the year of Jubilee, it was 1 year. But under Jesus, Jesus is our Jubilee. We're in a perpetual Jubilee, which means perpetual freedom. Is this pretty simple? Pretty simple, huh? So we live in this freedom. That means that since Jesus, it has been the year of Jubilee. That means the year of freedom. That means that the stuff about, well, yeah, but see, I've gone into bondage. No. What you've had is an enemy wrongfully attack you. Well, yeah, but I gave him opportunity. I opened the door for him. All right? You know, I let him in. I left the door open. Well, let's go back to legal terms. If you have, let me give you a scenario. You were standing in the front door of your house, And you can see the little convenience store down on the block, on the corner of the block by your house. And you think, I'm going to run down the store, get something to drink, I'll be back in 5 minutes, and I don't want to have to lock up the house and everything, so you just leave the door unlocked. Now, you go down to the store, and just as soon as you get out of sight, you didn't see the thief, the criminal, standing over behind the tree, just kind of hanging around, but he sees you leave. And as soon as he sees you leave, he walks up to your front door. He kind of looks around a little bit, checking for you, watching for you, because he didn't know who else is in the house. So he walks up and starts to knock on the door. Nobody answers the door, so he kind of looks around a little bit. And the minute he just tries the doorknob, and the door opens. So he kind of leans in and yells, anybody here? Hello, anybody here? Didn't get a sound. So he goes on in. He goes in, he grabs a bag, he starts dumping all your silverware, all your stuff into it. He puts all this stuff in, but in the middle of it, you come back in the door. Now, if you're a good Christian, when you come back in, you have to go, oh, I left the door open. You've got a right to be here because I left the door open. Take what you want, and I guess when you're done, I will have learned my lesson. You see how stupid that is? Well, that's the church. See, you thought Jesus was being nice when he called us sheep. Do you know that sheep are dumb, blind, stupid, hard? You know, do you ever realize that? He wasn't being nice. We think, oh, he's calling us little sheep. He's saying, you dumb things. Maybe not. But anyway, gets the point across. Amen. But now think about this. What are you going to do? You're going to go. Now think. If someone's in your house and you come back, can you call the cops? Yeah, you call them, and if the guy's stupid enough, he stays there until they get there, right? Now, in Texas, we don't call cops. We go to our closet. See, we don't call 911. We call the coroner. Okay, it's a little bit different. Yeah, and we try to raise them from the dead, too. We really try. It doesn't always work, but we try. Had a pastor one time that told me, if somebody breaks in my house, I'll tell you real quick, you got about 3 seconds, and then we're going to see if I can raise the dead. Kind of gives you an idea of the people that I was raised around, okay? He was an ex-Houston cop, and he was also a security for the Choctaw Nation, Indian Nation at one time, and he was also the pilot for the Happy Hunters at one time. So he had quite a bit of background. Well, now, this person is in your house. You call the cops. Now, if you can't throw them out, the cops can when they get there. Isn't that right? And now, think about this. Even if you left the door open, it may not be... There's actually different levels of crime being committed here, okay? If you left the door wide open, first off, when they got onto your property, it's trespassing, right? Because you did not invite them. You did not say, I want you to come here. If you left the door open and they come in, now if they kick in the door, then it's breaking and entering, right? If you left the door open, it's just called illegal entry. But every one of these, and if they grab stuff while they're in there, it is actual burglary. And it can, and matter of fact, not that you should do this, but burglary of a house is much worse than burglary of a building. Right? You burglarize a business, you don't get near as much trouble as you do for burglarizing a house. Maybe I shouldn't be telling you this, but it's a fact. Because burglary of a habitation is much more dangerous because they assume that you could hurt somebody that's in the house. Okay, so it's much more dangerous. Plus, it's a person's things as opposed to a company's things. Now, but you realize it's all crimes. Isn't it right? Now, the cop is not going to come and say, well, do you want him here? Well, of course not. All right. Oh, wait a minute. Did you leave a door unlocked? Well, yeah, that's how you got in. Oh, well, I'm sorry. I wish we could help you. But until you learn to lock your doors, we can't really do anything about it. He's not going to say, if he does that, you're going to report him, right? Because you're not going to let the thief walk out with this stuff. At any time that you don't want him there, you tell him to go, he has to go. Whether you left the door open or not. Do you realize? Remember what I said yesterday? If you are not your own, but you've been bought with a price and you belong to Jesus, you don't have the right to open a door. You don't have the right to invite him in. That is not your right. You don't belong to you. You get that? You belong to Jesus. Did Jesus invite him in? You are Jesus' property. You know, you want to think in terms of a slave, think like that. A person, do you realize that even under the old covenant, go back and read the laws. If a person struck another person's slave, then the person who struck the slave was accountable to death just as if they had struck the owner. Think about that. And yet we have all of these little reasons, so-called, you know, spiritual reasons of why the enemy can afflict us. You have to the thing that you forget is this. He was a criminal from the beginning. He was a criminal before he got to your house. Now, you take a bank robber. Bank robber goes in, robs a bank, comes out, goes across the street. There's this little old lady out there. He's trying to get away, but he sees this little old lady. He has robbed a bank. But, for some reason, he takes the time to help this little old lady across the street while he goes across the street. Now, if the cops pull up, do you think they're going to say, "Oh, but look at his heart. He's really a kind person"? Did helping the little old lady across the street nullify the fact that he just robbed a bank? Of course not. He was a criminal before he helped the little old lady. Isn't that right? So he was a criminal, and so therefore everything he did after being a criminal was also technically a criminal act. You get that? Because a criminal performed it. Do you understand what I'm saying? So it didn't make him any better because he did a good deed. He was still a criminal. And he still had to pay for what he did originally, right? Well, when the thief comes to your body, when he tries to steal your kidneys, tries to steal your liver, tries to steal your heart, your lungs, he is still a thief. He was a thief when I don't care what you did. Now, this woman I was telling you about was a woman that had emphysema. I went in, I prayed for her. First time in some of the dates and years blur with some of the different healings, but I know it was over 4 years, between 4 and 7 years. She had this breathing machine. She was on it when I got there. You know, I sound like Darth Vader. You know, I had that thing going, breathing like that. And I prayed for her. She takes the thing off. Man, you ought to have seen her. She was excited. Everybody else there was excited. She was absolutely healed. While I was there, I saw it. She saw it. She felt it. She could breathe. Couldn't breathe in her lungs. Hadn't breathed in years. Now she's free. I go to the rest of the other 20 people in her house. When I'm done, I look for them like, where's the lady? Is there? I think she's outside. Okay, well, I'm going to go and I'll see you later. I step out on the front porch. She's out there smoking a cigarette. And I told her, I said, "You're free. What are you doing?" And, you know, I was kind of riled up, to be honest with him. It's her life. But I told her, I said, I got that off of you. And she said, "Yeah, but I enjoy a good cigarette." I'm like, then enjoy the good emphysema that comes with it. Because it's going to come. I can get you free. But if you keep going back into it, you're going to get it back again. It went. Now, she was healed. Somebody go, "Well, I guess she didn't get healed because I saw her on that breathing machine." Yes, she did get healed. But she kept going back and a worse thing came upon her. And I guarantee you, if she doesn't change that, she will die. Do you see what I'm getting at? I can get you free. You can get anybody free. But you can't keep them free. Right? We can bring the kingdom of God to them. You know the old saying, you can take a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. It's the same thing. You can get people free, but you can't make them stay free. Amen?